I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen.
Amen. Amen. morning and welcome to the King's Report this Tuesday, March 21st, 2017, 8th year of Chengi, 2nd month, 24th day. I'm your host, Hyeongju-sean Moon, the 2nd King of Chunhyuguk. Let's go first to Tim Elder for our AccuWeather forecast this morning.
It's cloudy and 36 degrees outside at the Chunhyuguk right now. And as we approach the dawn, the temperature will dip slightly below freezing. As the day goes on, we'll have increasing sun, and the temperature will get up to 53 degrees. So this will be second day of spring, second spring-like day. But then tomorrow it's going to be cold. It's going to get the high will be 31 degrees, and then the low will be 13. So wow. Tomorrow and the day after cold, then Saturday and Sunday better.
Wow, isn't that, that's tremendous.
Thursday, Friday better.
Now we have in June, end of June,
yes,
we have a advanced level professional trekking marathon that is going to be through the Rocky Mountains at 10,000 feet, 35 miles. Okay, and the organizers suggest that you have to train 150 miles before that date. So we only have 100 days to pack in 150 miles. And we're gonna have to train simulating elevation, which means we're gonna have to cover our mouths with handkerchiefs and restrict breathing so that it's harder to breathe as we carry 40 to 50 pound packs, four to 5 days per week for the next 3 months until it becomes June. That's not a joke. That's not a joke. That's harder than the Korean military, actually. Andy was telling us about his experience with the Korean military. They had the guys trekking like 20 some miles, and it was not up mountainous terrain. It was not at 10,000 feet elevation, of course. And they had roads that they were doing, mountains and roads. But here, this will be completely wild and very, very intense. So all those who are coming, you better start training. You better start training. We'll also have a whole group going as well, just camping at the foot of the hills in different national parks, and then meet up with us after the trek. But this is going to be a trek of a lifetime. Tickets are already probably sold out by now. You have to actually get tickets. And it is going to be unbelievably difficult, you know. So we talked with our kids this morning about it during our hundukke, and told them that we're gonna get ready from Thursday. We'll be training after the King's Report, hitting that. So we are blessed if it's cooler weather as we prepare for this epic, extremely difficult advanced level professional trekking marathon that's coming up. So all those out in the kingdom of God, pray for us as we start training our peace militia training and get ready for this most epic and difficult adventure. Okay, pray for us, please. Alrighty, folks, we're going now to Revelation. This is our Rima today in Revelation chapter 22. Subsection, the river of life. And he showed me a pure river of water of life, clear as crystal, proceeding from the throne of God and of the Lamb. In the middle of the street and on either side of the river was the tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. And there shall be no more curse, but the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, and his name shall be on their foreheads. There shall be no night there. They need no lamp nor light of the sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. Amen. Adieu. Praise God. We are talking now in Book of Revelation, verse 22 of the New Jerusalem, and of the river of life, that is pouring from the throne of God and of the Lamb. On each side of this river is a tree of life, which bore 12 fruits, each tree yielding its fruit every month. Now it's interesting, in the Garden of Eden, there was a tree of life, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, but here in the kingdom, there's the tree of life. There's the tree of life. The tree of life are on either side of the river. So there's multiple trees of life that are bearing 12 fruit, each tree yielding its fruit every month. And of course, we know the tree of life is a symbol for Adam. So it's the Adamic culture and the kingship. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations, and there shall be no more curse. The leaves of the tree, interesting that the Constitution is created by leaves. Trees, isn't it? Trees? Paper. Paper is trees, isn't it?
Yes.
Paper are trees. And the Constitution is for the healing of the nations. There shall be no more curse. The curse of what? The archangel? But the throne of God and the Lamb shall be in it, and his servants shall serve him. They shall see his face, his name shall be on their foreheads. There shall be no night there, they'll need no lamp, nor light of the sun, for the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. Amen. It is in the kingdom. And as the Chinigo Constitution covers the earth, the light of God, there it is right there, the light of God shall be over the world. The tree of life and the river of life stemming from Christ, which is then encoded in law, gives us life. It gives us the gifts of life, freedom, responsibility, the gift of freedom from the archangel. It was unbelievable. I got a ticket the other day for having a late inspection on the car, you know, which is I didn't notice that. We forgot that. The police gave us a ticket about that issue. And so we paid the ticket, got the inspection done. And then in the mail, I get this mail saying that there's a warrant for my arrest for an inspection ticket signed by a local judge. What? I'm saying, what the heck is this? You know, it said like, officer, I can't remember his name, Ernest something or whatever, is commanded to take you into custody. It's a $129 inspection ticket, which we paid. And of course, we called the bureau and everything's cleared up. Everything's fine now. But it was ridiculous. Total fear. It's heavy-handed tax collection. It was ridiculous. That they will send a warrant for your arrest. There's not even a warning. Like, oh, we didn't receive your payment for your ticket. They send you a letter that says there's a warrant for your arrest. Why? Because you had a late inspection. What the hell is this? This is ridiculous. This is literally. This is even at this in this very countryside area, or we're in the wilderness area. You still have heavy-handed, fear-mongering, archangelic power here. It's unbelievable. Let alone New York, let alone New York, New Jersey. My goodness, give me a break. I mean, this is ridiculous. But what it does, it creates fear within the population. And of course, it's just meant to collect taxes and collect monies. There's nothing in the Constitution that allows them to be taxing vehicles. There's actually a whole series on YouTube about the right of travel. And you have these people who actually have the law printed out, and they keep it in their glove compartment, and they actually get pulled over. They have no registration, no inspection on their cars, and they get pulled over, and the police says, well, you need to do this, you need that. And they say, no, I'm not doing any business in this state. I'm just traveling through. And the police are basically saying, it doesn't matter. We have this law that changed. And then he's like, okay, please cite that law for me. He gives the officer the actual printed out law with the right to travel. And the officer goes to his car, comes back, and he says, okay, go. This guy has no registration, no inspection, no ticket, no. It's legally, you have a right to travel in the United States without paying a federal bureaucracy. But people don't know that, and obviously people do not prepare and people are scared. It's scary to do that. But there are people on YouTube that actually evoke that constitutional right and show them the paperwork, and they actually get off. Anyways, the point is that is ridiculous. That is absurdity, even on something small like that, which should be actually be illegal. In Chinigo, that's illegal. Creates fear. When I go to New York or New Jersey and I see police every block, it's ridiculous to have that kind of police presence and see that as normal. That's not normal. It creates fear. It creates a surveillance state, as if we feel like we're being surveilled. Not to say that law enforcement is bad. It is a very important profession, but in the kingdom, everybody has to be law enforcement. Everybody is peace police, peace militia. When citizens are peace police, peace militia, then we can cover each other's backs and we can protect each other. But having this type of warrants being issued for a late inspections, which wasn't even late, it was just crossed in the mail, the payment was made. I mean, just, it's so ridiculous to have this kind of fear-mongering in the United States. This is the heavy-handed, it's a small example of the heavy-handedness of the Archangel that is ruling over us. But in the kingdom and the New Jerusalem, there is a river of life, from which healing comes to all the nations. To be healed of the curse, they said, the Bible said, the curse of what? Who gives curse? Satan. Archangelic culture is a curse. But the healing comes, the throne of God and Lamb shall be in it, and his servant shall serve him. And in that land there shall be no more night, but there shall be God's light. The Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign and rule over the world and over that kingdom forever and ever. It is our prayer this morning for all the kings and queens of Chinigok and the tribal kings and queens that stand with the King of Kings and the Chinigok Constitution, that we will pray today. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. It will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We'll be right back after this short break.
Magnum Research and Auto Ordnance, the Car Firearms Group, with a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology. It's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Car Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the history of the 1911 and the Tommy Gun, to the best in compact concealed carry, Car Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealment, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Carr Firearms Group. Made in the USA. Visit Carr.com today. Carr Arms, Magnum Research, and Auto Ordnance. The Carr Firearms Group. With a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology, it's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Carr Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the history of the 1911 and the Tommy Gun, to the best in compact concealed carry, Carr Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealment, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Carr Firearms Group. Made in the USA. Visit Carr.com today. Carr Arms, Magnum Research, and Auto Ordnance. The Carr Firearms Group. With a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology, it's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Carr Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the history of the 1911 and the Tommy Gun, to the best in compact concealed carry, Carr Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealment, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Carr Firearms Group. Made in the USA. Visit Carr.com today.
And we are back. Welcome back to the King's Report this Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. I'm your host, Hyungjin Sean Moon, the second king of Chunhyang-guk. And we just covered the incredible Revelation 22, the River of Life. Let me read you one section before that. Incredible. In the last, Revelation 21, this is really amazing. Look at this. The glory of the New Jerusalem. But I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. Right there. Right there. Christ is the temple. The city had no need of the sun or the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light, and the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. Did you hear that, folks? The kings of the earth who are able to enter the Lamb with the Lamb's Book of Life, they're in the kingdom, bring their glory and honor into it. Its gates shall not be shut at all by day, and they shall bring the glory and the honor of the nations into it. But there shall by no means enter anything that defiles or causes an abomination or lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Beautiful. That is amazing. Amazing, amazing. Let's now go to Mrs. Kang for our Holy Spirit moment with Mrs. Kang.
The King read from the last book of the Bible. Mrs. Kang will be speaking today from the first book, Genesis.
Chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters.
안녕하십니까?
Good morning, everyone.
오늘 여러분들에게 말씀드릴 내용은 제일 제가 처음으로 개척 나갔던 한 토막의 말씀을 드리기로 하겠습니다.
Today I'd like to speak to you about something that happened when I first went out pioneering.
저는 우리 육신의 부모님께 늘 감사를 드리고 있습니다.
I'm always grateful to my physical parents.
왜냐하면은 하나님과 또 예수님을 내게 상속해 주시고 상속받아서 내가 그대로 살 수 있다는 걸 생각할 때마다 얼마나 고맙고 감사한지 모르겠어요.
My parents gave to me a knowledge of God and Jesus, and it's because of them that I was able to receive God and Jesus, inherit them, God and Jesus from them, and to live my life with God and Jesus. So I was extremely grateful to them.
그래서 참 어려서부터 저는 하나님 살아 계시다는 것을 아주 마음에 깊이 새기면서 살았습니다.
So I've lived my life from a very early age with the knowledge in my heart that God is alive.
왜냐하면은 성경 창세기 1장 1절 제일 첫머리에 하나님이 태초에 하나님이 천지 만물을 창조하셨다는 이 한 말씀을 늘 읽을 때마다 가슴속 깊이 아 이 태초에 천지 만물을 창조하신 하나님을 내가 알고 믿고 또 그대로 하나님을 주님을 많은 사람들에게 전하게 되었다는 것을 생각할 때는 얼마나 고마운지 모르겠어요.
The Bible begins with a statement that in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. That in the beginning God was there and that he created the heaven and the earth. And I cannot express in words how grateful I am that I am able to know the God who created the heaven and the earth, that I am able to live my life with him.
그래서 저 나름대로 하나님은 살아계신 하나님이었고 천지 만물을 창조하신 하나님이라는 것을 가슴속 깊이 심어놓고 살 때에 나는 정말로 뜻있는 생활, 값있는 생활, 또 더 나아가서 많은 사람들에게 이 하나님과 또 예수님을 전해야 되겠다는 거기에 미쳐서 살아왔던 것입니다.
My life truly has had meaning and has had value because I've been able to live with this knowledge of God. And I've been honored in, with the mission to be able to spread this knowledge of God and of Jesus to many people.
그래서 아버님을 만나 뵙게 되고 또 아버님께서 그때에 제게 개척을 좀 나가보라고 말씀하셨어요.
It's because of this that I was able to meet Father. It was because of this that Father told me to go out pioneering.
어디로 나가면 좋겠습니까? 이렇게 물어보았더니 아버님께서 하신 말씀이 대구는 참 잘 믿는 사람들이 많아. 그러니까 대구에 나가서 처음으로 개척을 좀 해보라고 제게 강요했습니다.
I asked him, well, where should I go? And he said, there are many people in the city of Daegu who are faithful people. So go to Daegu and witness to the faithful people there.
1953년, 52년에 입교해서 53년 7월 20일 날인데 아버님께서 그날을 정해주시면서 대구에 가서 개척을 하라고 해서 나가게 되었습니다.
I met Father in 1952, and it was on July 20th, 1953, that he instructed me to go out. And so I left that day for Daegu and began my pioneer witnessing.
그날은 범일동에서 지나다가 이제 거기서 생활하다가 그 다음에 수정동으로 옮겼어요. 그런데 그날 아침이 아니고 새벽이에요. 새벽에 저를 부르셔서 들어갔습니다.
When I first met Father, he was living in that hut in Pomirdong section of Busan. But then later he moved to another location in Sujeongdong in Busan. So we were in Sujeongdong then when one morning, actually very early one morning, Father called me, and so I went into his room to meet him.
그때는 전도하는 사람이 아무도 없어요. 그래서 아버님께서 제가 전도사 생활을 하다가 들어왔기 때문에 전도하는 것을 맡겨서 그래서 개척도 하고 전도도 하고 해왔습니다.
At that time, no one was witnessing among the people who were around Father. That I had been an evangelist before I joined Father, and so Father told me to take responsibility for witnessing and for pioneering.
아버님 하신 말씀이 개척이라는 것은 쉬운 것이 아니라고 또 더 나아가서 이 전도하는 것도 쉬운 것이 아니고 남의 그 생명을 하나님 앞으로 주님 앞으로 이끄는 것이기 때문에 이것은 해 혼자만이 알 수 있고 느낄 수 있다고 했어요.
Father said pioneering is not an easy thing. And also witnessing is not an easy thing. That when you are witnessing to someone, you are taking their life and you are leading their life to God. So this is something that is difficult that can be understood only by someone that has experienced it.
아버님 말씀은 이제 대구에 가서 개척을 하는데 그런데 40일을 꼭 채우고 오라는 거예요. 만약에 39일 된 저녁에 찾아온다고 해도 나는 그때부터는 강현실이하고는 대면도 하지 않고 말도 하지 않고 쫓아내버린다고 했어요.
The father said, go to Daegu and make sure that you pioneer for 40 days. If you come back on the evening of the 39th day, I'll have nothing to do with you. From that time on, I will not meet you and I will not talk to you and I have nothing to do with 강현실.
그래서 저는 아이고 굉장히 무서운 곳에 들어왔구나. 이거 40일을 안 채우게 되면은 내가 여기서 쫓겨나는데 생각하니까 아주 심각했습니다.
And I thought then, wow, I've really come into a very fearful group here. He says that I have to go there for 40 days, and if I don't fulfill the 40 days, then I'll be kicked out of this place.
그래 개척을 나간다고 하니까. 그때 식구들이 다 쳐봐도 열 사람도 안 돼요. 그런데 이득삼 그 형님이 내가 개척 나간다 그러니까 옷을 두 벌 사가지고 왔어요.
At that time, there were less than 10 people who were with Father. Father instructed me to go out, and so the others heard about this. And one person went out and bought two sets of clothing for me.
그런데 두 벌을 분명히 사왔는데 한참 있다가 보니까 한 벌밖에는 없고 한 벌은 없어져서 이상하다 생각했어요.
The person, I knew that person bought two outfits for me, but after a while, when I was about to leave, I noticed that one was missing. I couldn't find the other one.
그때 아버님께서 말씀하시기를 내가 한 벌을 치웠는데 왜냐하면은 2000년 전에 예수님께서 제자들을 전도내 보낼 때에 두 벌 옷을 가지지 말고 돈 전대도 가지지 말고 보냈기 때문에 나도 강현실이한테 두 벌 옷을 주면 안 되고 돈 전대도 주면 지갑도 주면 안 된다고 그렇게 말씀하셨어요.
Father said that he had put away the other outfit the person had bought. And he said that you can only take one, because 2,000 years ago, when Jesus sent his disciples out, he told them not to take two sets of clothes. He said that they should only take one. And also, you cannot take a lot of money. You have to take little or no money. You cannot have your wallet with you.
40일을 저보고 있다가 오라고 했는데 40일을 개척 또 교회를 하나 세우고 오라고 그랬어요. 어? 그런데 돈은 한 푼도 안 가지고 그냥 나가게 되니까 속으로 좀 이상했습니다. 왜냐하면은 40일 있으려면은 돈은 쌀 한 대 살 돈밖에 안 줘서 이거 가지고 40일을 어떻게 먹고 어떻게 지나다고 가야 되나 걱정도 했어요.
So he sent me out with almost no money, just enough, barely enough money to buy a little bit of rice. And I was wondering, how am I going to survive for 40 days? He told me to go there for 40 days, but how am I going to survive?
그래서 마음으로 공산당 보다가도 더 무서운 곳에 내가 들어왔구나 이런 생각도 했습니다.
And so I thought, wow, I've joined a group that is even more fearful than the communists.
그래 준비를 해가 준비라고 하는 건 그때 아무것도 없어요. 옷 집은 옷을 집어넣을 가방 하나도 없이 그냥 흰 보자기에다가 옷을 싸고 그때에 아버님이 제게 원리 원본을 주셨습니다. 그러시면서 하시는 말씀이 이거 가서 말씀 전할 내용 자본이니까 이것만 가지고 가면 된다고 해서 원리 원본하고 성경 찬송만 가지고 제가 떠났습니다.
And I made my preparations, but there really was no way that I could really pack either because I didn't have a suitcase or anything like that. I just had a white cloth, a large white cloth that I could wrap my everything in, my clothes in. And Father gave that as I was about to leave. Father gave me a copy of the Worldly Wonbun, that is the handwritten principle that Father had wrote himself. And he said, "This is all you need. Just take this and preach from this." So I went with the Worldly Wonbun book and a copy of the Bible and a hymn book, and that was all I took.
그래서 보따리를 하나 들고 아버님께 인사를 드리기 전에 아버님이 기도를 했었어요. 무슨 기도를 했었는가 하면은 오늘 어린 딸이 그때는 아주 젊은 때였으니까 20대였으니까요. 어린 딸이 대구에 개척을 나갑니다. 하나님 꼭 같이 해주셔서 대구에 하나님의 몸된 교회를 세우고 들어올 수 있게 해달라는 간절한 기도를 해주셔서 그 기도 말씀을 드리면서 저는 생각을 많이 했습니다.
잠깐 거기까지요. So as she was about to leave, Father prayed for her. And he prayed to God, saying, God, Father, this young daughter, at that time, Mrs. Kang was in her 20s, and so he called her his young daughter, is about to go out pioneering in Daegu. Please be with her, and please help her and allow her to establish your church in Daegu before she returns.
누구 하나 같이 따라가 주는 사람도 없고, 혼자서 하면서 저는 무슨 생각을 했느냐 하면은 아버님께서 그때는 선생님이라고 했어요. 선생님께서 나 하나를 전도 내 보내시면서 정말로 교회를 하나 세우고 돌아오기를 바라고 또 더 나아가서는 2000년 전에 예수님께서 제자들을 전도내 보내였던 그때를 생각하시면서 돈 한 푼 주시지 않고 그냥 쫓아내 버렸습니다.
So she left the Busan where Father was, and she thought to herself, "Wow, Father. At that time, we didn't call him Father; we called him Teacher. Teacher really wants me to go and establish a church in 40 days, without giving me." Basically no money, just to go and to be with God. As he does this, he's thinking of what Jesus did 2,000 years ago, how he sent his disciples out. So this is really a very serious thing.
지금도 저는 어려운 일이 있고 어려운 사건이 닥쳐오면은 아버님이 저 하나를 전도로 내보내시면서 통곡하시면서 기도하셨던 그 내용을 지금도 생각할 때가 많이 있습니다.
Even now, when I'm faced with difficulty, I often remember the way that Father prayed for me in tears as he sent me out on that witnessing mission.
복귀 역사는 쉬운 것이 아니었고 어려운 것인데 정말로 저는 그때 젊었어요. 젊은 강현실이를 내가 외지의 대구 땅에 내어 보내고 싶은 생각은 하나도 없지만은 내어 보내지 않으면 안 될 내 마음을 좀 알아달라는 그런 말씀도 하셨습니다.
The father also said that the history of restoration is not easy. It's very difficult. He said that he did not want to send me out, but he had to send me out because it was necessary that I go out. And he asked me to please understand his heart.
그는 그때 저는 성경은 좀 알았지만은 원리는 그렇게 잘 알지도 못하고 또 더 나아가서는 강의할 수 있는 그런 자리에 서지도 못했어요.
At that time, I knew a little bit about the Bible, but I knew almost nothing about the principle, and I was not in a position where I could lecture the principle.
그래서 저는 대구에 가기 위해서 보따리를 싸가지고 부산 진역에서 기차를 탔습니다.
So I took my things are wrapped in that white cloth and I went to the railroad station of Busanjin.
기차를 타고 가면서 생각을 많이 했어요. 내가 이 길을 가기로 약속을 하고 선생님하고 약속을 했는데 죽어도 나는 가기는 해야 되는데 참 혼자서 가려니까 아주 어려웠습니다.
And as I was on that train to Daegu, I thought to myself, this is a path that I promised a teacher that I would go, but it's a very difficult path, and I was very concerned about that, what would happen.
대구역에서 내렸어요. 그래가지고는 저는 어디에 발을 옮겨놓아야 될지 생각이 나질 않았습니다.
I arrived at the railroad station in Daegu and I got off the train, but I had no idea of what I would do after that.
그래서 저는 하나님, 나 어디로 가야 되겠습니까? 아직 어디로 발을 옮겨놓아야 될지 생각이 나지 않습니다. 그렇게 기도를 했습니다.
So I prayed to God. God, what shall I do now? Where shall I, in what direction should I walk? I have no idea. Where should I go? What I should do?
그때 제 귀에 들려온 음성이 있었어요. 무슨 음성이었느냐 하면은 너는 아직 하루도 이 길을 가지 않고 어렵다고 하느냐. 나는 6천년이란 긴 기간 동안 하나의 뜻을 이루어 놓기 위해서 지금까지 나는 어려운 길을 가고 있는데 하루도 못 참아서 그런 생각을 하느냐 하는 그 음성을 듣고 정신을 제가 바짝 차렸던 것입니다.
In that moment I heard a voice. The voice said to me, You haven't even been going on this path for a single day. I've been doing this for 6,000 years. Trying to accomplish a single objective, but you cannot even endure this for a single day. Don't complain. And that was when I came to my senses.
그래서 이왕이면은 내가 정말로 개척을 나왔다면은 성공을 하고 들어가고 교회를 세우고 들어가야 된다는 그 뜻에서 하나님 도와주십시오. 주님 함께해 주십시오. 매여 달렸던 것입니다.
So I prayed, God, so as long as I've come here, I have to succeed. I have to go back on the foundation of success. Oh, please help me. God, please help me. Lord, please help me.
그래 그날 이왕 가려면은 제일 큰 교회를 찾아가야 되겠다고 해서 대구에 서문교회라고 있는데 아주 수천 명이 모이는 교회예요.
So I thought, well, as long as I'm going to do this, I might as well go to the largest Christian church in Daegu. So I went to the large church called the Seomun Church. It has a congregation in the thousands.
그래 거기 들어가서 철야 기도를 했습니다.
I went into the church and I prayed all night.
철야 기도를 하고 아침에 나와서 보니까 어떤 권사님이 한 분 서 계세요. 그래 그분이 나는 오늘 저 안지쟁이 산이라는 데 가서 기도를 하기로 했는데 같이 갈 수 없겠느냐 해서 거기를 같이 따라가게 되었습니다.
And in the morning, as I left the, went out of the door of the church, I met a woman who was one of the members of the congregation, and she was going to go to a nearby mountain to do her early morning prayer. And so, and she gave me permission to go with her to pray together.
전도는 간절한 심정이 앞서야 되고 정말로 하나님과 예수님을 내가 체험하고 또 내게 가치와 계신다는 실감나는 그 자리에 서지 않고는 전도는 되지 않는다는 것을 저는 느꼈습니다.
And I felt then that witnessing really takes a very sincere heart. And it requires us to put ourselves in the position where we are together with God and Jesus. We are experiencing God and Jesus.
그래서 안지쟁이 산 거기를 올라가면서 저는 기도하고 처음 개척이기 때문에 기도하고 또 그 다음에는 하나님 살아 계심을 나는 누구를 만나든지 가슴 속에 그 씨를 심어야 되겠다는 마음을 가지고 가게 되니까 힘이 나더라고요.
Now I went up the mountain and I prayed there because this was the beginning of my pioneer witnessing mission. I prayed for that. And I also prayed that I would be able to plant the seeds in people's hearts that they would understand that God is alive.
그래서 올라가다가 중간에서 저는 노래를 하나 또 불렀습니다. 오너라 동무야 동산에 보면 때마다 비치며 즐기는 이날을 노래하리 에덴의 동무들아. 그러면서 옛날 그 아버님하고 같이 그 조그마한 방에서 부르던 그 노래를 불렀습니다.
On my way up the mountain, I sang a song, and this was a song about the Garden of Eden and about being with God. And it was a song that I had sung with her father many times.
그랬더니 그때부터 하늘이 역사를 하시더라고요.
And that was when heaven began its spiritual works of miracles.
그래서 노래를 불렀는데 한 열 사람이 찾아왔어요. 제가 노래 부르는데. 그런데 그 사람들 얘기가 뭐라고 하는가 하면은 아, 그 노래를 들으니까 저거는 사람이 부르는 노래가 아니고 정말로 천사들이 내려와서 부르는 노래이다. 그러면서 제게 찾아와서 보드님은 뭐라고 하는가 하면은 아이고 여기 사람이 있네요 그래요. 그래서 속으로 저 사람들이 나를 짐승으로 봤나 왜 사람 있네요 하는 그런 얘기를 할까 생각했습니다.
And as I sang that song, about 10 people came to me, gathered around me. And they said that we heard you singing and we couldn't believe that this was a human being singing. We thought it must be an angel. But we come here and we see that it's a human being. And I thought to myself, well, yeah, I'm a human being. What did they think? I was an animal? But they came to me as I was singing that song.
그랬더니 남문교회에 집사, 권사 10명쯤 돼요. 그래서 와서 제가 그네들이 여기에 사람이 있네요 하면서 하는 얘기가 아이고 보니까 뭘 성경도 많이 알고 또 여러 가지를 보니까 뭘 좀 아시는 분 같은데 우리는 여기 산기도를 왔으니까 그러니까 여기서 말씀을 좀 해주면 좋겠다 그래서 그네들을 상대해서 말씀을 전하게 되었습니다.
These were 10 people were Christians from the Nammun Church in Daegu, and they came to me like that, and they asked me to speak to them about God's word, and so I did.
말씀을 전하는데 정말로 그네들이 아버님께서 원리 원본을 주시면서 이걸 가지고 전하라고 했기 때문에 그 말씀을 중심 삼고 말씀을 전했더니 놀라운 기적의 역사가 많이 일어나더라고요.
Father had given me a copy of the Worldly Wonbon that he had handwritten himself and told me to use that. And so I spoke to them centering on the content of that book. And amazing miracles began to happen then.
그래서 그분들이 제가 드리는 원리 강의 이걸 듣고는 모두가 하는 얘기가 30년, 40년 동안 예수 믿었지만은 한 번도 이런 이야기는 못 들었는데 정말로 들어보니까 하나님은 살아계신 하나님이었다는 것을 느끼게 되었다고 하면서 그네들이 너무 좋아했어요.
And they thought it was wonderful. They said, we've been believing in God and Jesus, some of us for 30 years, some for 40 years, but we never heard anything like this. And this really helps us understand that God is alive. It's wonderful that you are saying this.
그래서 일주일 동안을 거기에서 말씀을 제가 하는데 정말로 기적이 일어났다는 것은 무슨 기적이냐 하면은 이네들이 잠을 자질 않아요. 또 뭐냐면 밥도 먹지 않고 금식을 하면서 말씀을 드리면서 정말로 몇십 년 동안 믿으면서 느낄 수 없었던 큰 은혜를 느낄 수 없었던 새로운 말씀을 듣게 되었다고 너무너무 고맙고 감사하게 생각한다고 하면서 아주 좋아했습니다.
And I continued to witness to them for about a week. And the amazing thing is that they wouldn't sleep and they wouldn't eat. They just wanted to continue to hear about God's word. And it was because they never heard anything like this. They never received so much inspiration and grace through any message before in their lives.
그리고 아버님께서 영적으로 그 산에 찾아오셨어요. 그래서 옛날 범일동 수정동에서 입으셨던 그대로 회색 바지에다가 모시 이 노타이를 입으시고 찾아오셨어요.
And then Father came to that mountain spiritually. He came and we saw him wearing the gray pants that he wore both in Pomirtong and later in Sujongdong, and also the clothing that the upper outfit, that upper part of his outfit as well, was what he had been wearing.
그네들이 말씀을 듣는데 정말로 저는 깜짝깜짝 놀랄 일들이 많았습니다. 자기네들이 그래요. 왠지 모르게 우리는 여기 와서 말씀을 들으면서 뭘 느꼈느냐 하면은 하나님 살아계심과 주님 살아계심을 느끼는 반면에 새로운 이 말씀에 접하게 되니까 자기네들의 본 정신을 다 잃어버렸다는 미친 사람처럼 되었다는 이 얘기를 들었습니다.
And they said that they was incredible to you. They had incredible experiences listening to these words, God's words. They said that they had never heard anything like this, and that they said we are losing our minds over these words. We're not ourselves anymore.
그래서 그이들이 어떤 일이 있었느냐 하면은 사실은 돈도 안 가지고 아무것도 안 가지고 갔지만은 그네들이 선생님 대접을 하는데 얼마나 극진히 하게 되고 그 말씀 전할 때마다 모두 통곡하면서 말씀을 들었어요.
They would weep and, when I was speaking, and they were just so moved that it was incredible. I couldn't even believe it myself.
그래서 저는 아, 이 원리 말씀이 정말로 보통 말씀이 아니고 하나님이 함께 하시는 하나님이 주신 말씀이라는 것을 그때 저는 깊이 느끼게 되었던 것입니다.
And that was when I first began to feel that these words of the principle are truly powerful, that these words are really from God.
너무 기니까 이제 그 다음에 계속 하도록 하고 오늘은 그만하기로 하겠어요.
Well, I don't have time to speak any more about this. I will continue at another occasion. Thank you very much.
고맙습니다.
And we'll be right back after the short break. Welcome back to the King's Report this Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. I'm your host, Hyungjin Sean Moon, the second king of Chonhyuguk, and now we move to our news section. Top news on Drudge: FBI probing far-right news sites White House pushes back on Comey testimony. Buchanan says, will Russiagate backfire on the left? And main news on Drudge, Kim Jong-un blows up U.S. aircraft carrier in new video. A new propaganda video. Outrageous. There is an escalation of propaganda now, you can see. Ivanka Trump gets West Wing office as role expands. Web trouble. Search giant Google under fire. YouTubers claim restrictions targeting gay-themed content. Glenn Beck suspends Blaze TV hosts. Takes battle public. Tumblr under fire for ignoring revenge porn posts. Battered by scandal. Marines issue. Marines issue new social media policy. Feds ban electronics on flights from Middle East Africa. Spring fever. Kim Jong-un vows to reduce USA to ashes with nuke strikes. China arsenal of missiles at the ready. Hawking being sent to space. Secret Service theft caught on video. Knew what he was after. Billionaire David Rockefeller dies at 101. Sex robot with artificial G-spot can experience robo-orgasms. Of course, David Rockefeller being one of the most demonic Center for Foreign Relations billionaires working directly with the Rothschild Soros and the top, quote, globalists pushing for world governance. This is a man who in the 1970s wrote an article praising China and Mao Zedong, saying that he's increasing happiness and social well-being after he murdered 80 million innocent Asian people. This is one of the biggest demons on the earth, and he has died. NSA documents surveillance on Trump family and more. Project Dragnet. Great again, oil drops as U.S. drilling growth threatens to counter OPEC. Man claims New York City bar denied him service over pro-Trump hat. Conservative students say violently threatened. Video shows how Brady, Jersey thief, pulled it off. Bezos the robot, this insano Jeff Bezos, this liberal lunatic, in a robot made by a Korean robotic company, Hanguk Mide. Very, very dystopian, you can see how these elites get on power trips when they can have superhuman powers. And this is why they love technology, because it gives them superhuman powers. They don't want to extend to the human, to normal people. This guy is Bezos, of course. One of the fifth richest man on earth. And a totally, 100% global governance, restricting, giving restrictions on poor middle class people. Total super elite. You can see how they just froth at the mouth when they come into contact with something that makes them more powerful. They're so despicable. Norway unseats Denmark as world's happiest country. America ranked 14th. And it's always this guy, we may cover it a little later. It's just so ridiculous. He's there in his little thing. And he's up there squeamishly, laughing, ha ha, as he's moving the robot hands with these robotic, controls. I mean, the guy is just nuts. It makes me, he's like the prototypical, little mad scientist who wants to use wealth and technology to make himself feel more powerful. I mean, it's so despicable. You know these kind of people, when they're in power, will never do anything evil, right? These people will never use robotics against humanity, right? When we know there are known control freaks, there are known world government freaks, there are known political Satanists. No, but when they have this kind of power, that's not something to worry about. When they can walk around in 30-foot robots and threaten you with great power. Norway unseats Denmark as world's happiest country. America ranked 14th. Poll, half of Canadians want illegals deported. Look at that. Trump pressures sanctuary cities that won't hold illegals. Malibu now offering refuge. Tattoo removal business booming as fears of deportation mount. Spring breakers chant, build that wall in Cancun. Oh, 4chan using border webcams to report illegals. NYC commuter hell boost in ridership leaves platforms packed. Struggle to exit trains. Pack of aggressive ATV and dirt bike riders create havoc in Bay Area. Historic restoration of Jesus' burial shrine completed. NS New York Stock Exchange trading glitch. Price confusion. One-legged teenager wrestler eyeing NCAA title. Solar slump, sun blank for 2 weeks straight. French presidential candidates trade barbs in first debate. Ran nearly 3.5 hours. Macron versus Le Pen. Rachel Maddow wins second week in row in demo. Fox News polls Judge Napolitano over his Trump wiretap claims. Real-life robocops will soon replace human police. There it is, folks. Republican leadership sets up spin room ahead of healthcare vote battle. Gorsuch presents himself as consensus builder. Schumer calls for chaos. Anne Frank Center blasts Tim Allen for Nazi comparison. Have you lost your mind? Update, Brazil meat scandal deepens as China, EU, Chile bars import. And Paris display infectious humor. Make each other laugh. Those are the top headlines on Drudge. And for this hour, let's go now to David Woods' highly anticipated Psychology of Islam, Part 2, Muhammad's Rebellion. Just to give you a reminder, Part 1, we learned that the defective father hypothesis leads to certain expectations, given Muhammad's childhood experiences. In brief, based on DFH, defective father hypothesis, we would expect Muhammad to rebel against authority and tradition. We would expect him to have a problem with his father figures and especially with viewing God as a heavenly father. And we would expect him to have some difficulty finding normal relationships with other people. In this video, David Wood examines the historical evidence to see if our first expectation is along the way we help Sheikh Yasir Qadhi understand Allah better. Let's go now to David Wood's second video on the psychology of Islam.
Carl, Sigmund, my claws are the claws that cut the mind. In the film Logan, we learn that Wolverine naturally grows a full beard, which means that for the rest of the X-Men and Wolverine films, he was grooming himself so that he could look like this. Since Wolverine's hair grows at an accelerated rate, he must have been grooming himself daily. Why would he spend so much time in front of a mirror with a beard trimmer in order to give himself a particular look? Well, as we saw in an earlier installment of the franchise, young Wolverine was born in the 1800s to the wealthy landowners John and Elizabeth Howlett. Wolverine's birth name was James Howlett. One evening, poor Wolverine hears a bang and rushes downstairs to find that his father has been shot to death by the groundskeeper. The scene causes Wolverine's mutation to manifest, and he murders the groundskeeper with his bone claws. Tragically, it turns out that Wolverine's mother, Elizabeth, has had an affair with the groundskeeper, who shares these dying words.
He wasn't your father. Son.
Notice the groundskeeper's appearance. His name, Thomas Logan. Wolverine spent more than a century grooming himself to resemble his biological father, whom he had killed. He finally stopped the grooming sometime before the events in the most recent film, presumably after he had gained complete control over Professor X, a father figure who, ironically, was much younger than Wolverine. And yet he continued calling himself Logan. Seems we never really grow out of childhood trauma. Neither do prophets. In our last session, we discussed some of the psychological research on the impact dead or abusive fathers have on the religious beliefs of their children. The evidence shows that history's most prominent atheists and skeptics tended to have dead or abusive fathers or father figures during crucial periods of psychological development, and that history's most prominent theists tended to have close relationships with their fathers or father figures during the same period of life. Further evidence shows that the theists had far more positive relationships as adults, suggesting that abuse or abandonment by a father or father figure during childhood has a negative impact not only on a person's understanding of God, but also on future relationships in general. We then turned our attention to one of history's most famous orphans, Muhammad. Shortly after his birth, Muhammad was sent to live with a foster family in the desert. A few years later, he was taken away from his foster family and returned to his mother, who died when he was just 6 years old. His grandfather was the next to take him in, but his grandfather died 2 years later. Custody of Muhammad then fell to his uncle, who was too busy to pay much attention to young Muhammad, at least until Muhammad was able to help out with the caravan trade. So Muhammad wasn't just orphaned, he was repeatedly orphaned. He was a serial orphan. And our knowledge of psychology allows us to predict some of the adult characteristics of a serial orphan. But it also allows us to do much more. It allows us to help Islam's greatest scholars understand Allah. Now, later in this series, we're going to discover what Allah actually is. Spoiler alert, Allah is the suppressed subconscious of Muhammad. For now, however, I'm more concerned with the fact that because Muslim scholars don't understand psychology, they don't understand Allah according to their own religion. They try to understand Allah's intentions, but their ignorance of psychology leads them to false conclusions. Perhaps an example will help. Take Sheikh Yasser Qadi. Sheikh Qadi has spent many years studying the life of Muhammad, and he's lectured on Muhammad's childhood experiences.
So the Prophet's father passes away when his mother is pregnant with him, and his mother barely has 2.5 years really to take care of him and nourish him, because he was being taken care of by Halima as well. And then when the Prophet is barely 6 years old, he loses his mother and his father.
Moreover, Sheikh Qadi draws attention to the psychological impact of these childhood experiences. For instance, even the adult Muhammad broke down in tears when he visited the grave of his mother.
They say that the Prophet found a grave over there, and he sat down and he cried like we had never seen him cry before. Until his lihya, his beard, which is, mashallah, it is narrated, the Prophet had a very big beard. His beard was wet with tears.
Muhammad, when he was more than 50 years old, was so troubled by something that had happened when he was 6 years old that he sobbed until his beard was soaked with tears. Can we say that Muhammad's repeated losses as a child had a significant psychological effect on him?
The fact that the Prophet obviously is crying in this manner, I mean, we don't need to mention this is his mother. Really, it doesn't need to be mentioned, the love that he must have felt and the pain that he must have endured at the death of Amina.
But keep in mind that from an Islamic perspective, Allah really loves Muhammad. At times, Allah seems to have nothing better to do than to give Muhammad anything he wants. Even Muhammad's child bride, Aisha, noticed this. One day, after Muhammad received one of his morally convenient revelations, Aisha said to him in Sahih al-Bukhari 4788, "I feel that your Lord hastens in fulfilling your wishes and desires." So Allah loves Muhammad so much that he hastens to satisfy Muhammad's desires, and yet Muhammad was repeatedly orphaned as a child. The question that arises for Muslim scholars then is, why would Allah, who spent so much time satisfying Muhammad's desires as an adult, not satisfy Muhammad's childhood desire for a mother and a father?
Why did Allah Azza wa Jal put three orphan situations, three traumatic trials, one after the other, upon our Prophet?
The attempts of Muslim scholars to answer this question are a kind of theodicy. In the philosophy of religion, a theodicy is an attempt to explain why God, who's all-powerful and perfectly good, would allow various kinds of suffering in the world. An Islamic version of a theodicy would be an attempt to explain why Allah, who's all-powerful and loves to satisfy Muhammad's desires, put Muhammad through so much childhood trauma.
Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put so much trials and tribulations on the young child? Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will such a difficult childhood?
Sheikh Qadi offers several explanations, but all of them are wrong. He claims that Allah repeatedly orphaned Muhammad so that he, Allah, would be the one who cared for Muhammad.
Like Allah says about Musa alayhi salam in the Quran, وَاصْطَنَعْتُكَ لِنَفْسِي, I was the one who took care of you. Allah Azza wa Jal took care of our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and took this responsibility directly.
But this is just nonsense. Muhammad was taken to the desert where a wet nurse from the Banu Sa'd cared for him. Then his mother cared for him until she died. Then his grandfather cared for him until he died. Then his uncle made sure that he didn't starve to death until Muhammad could start working. Where is Allah in all of this? Now, of course, you can say, well, Allah is providing for Muhammad through all of these people. But you can say the exact same thing about children who have two wonderful parents. How are wonderful parents not a blessing from God? So how does repeatedly orphaning Muhammad make Allah more of a caregiver to Muhammad? Apart from this, Allah's miraculous care goes completely unnoticed. By the time Muhammad starts receiving revelations when he's 40 years old, he thinks he's demon-possessed. So what did Allah ultimately accomplish by caring for Muhammad by taking away everyone who was close to him?
Allah has a plan. Allah has a plan.
Sheikh Qadi also claims that Muhammad was orphaned so that he could be sent to the desert to learn excellent Arabic. The Arabic of the cities was regarded as corrupt because the city dwellers picked up too many foreign terms and so on. But the Arabic of the desert was pure, and this is what Muhammad learned.
Another benefit of this is that this facilitated the Prophet's being raised in the Banu Sa'd so that he could become the most eloquent of the Arabs.
Three problems here. First, sending babies to live in the desert for a while was a custom of the rich. Muhammad only ended up being taken there because one of the desert wet nurses who came to Mecca couldn't find anyone else and was ashamed to go back without a baby. So Allah didn't need to orphan Muhammad to have him sent to the desert to learn Arabic. Wealthy parents would have done that, as even Sheikh Qadi admits.
In fact, this was a custom of the elite of the Quraysh. It was a custom of the nobility of the Quraysh.
Second, Muhammad was only in the desert for a few years. He was around 4 years old when he was sent back to his biological mother in Mecca. Sheikh Qadi's theodicy requires us to believe that Muhammad became history's greatest master of Arabic at the ripe old age of four.
And it is well known that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke the best Arabic. And in fact, there is a hadith to this regard as well, that Allah has blessed me with the most succinct, the most precise of all speech.
Third, Sheikh Qadi's claim actually backfires against the main argument for the truth of the Quran. The Quran's central argument is that any chapter of the Quran is so wonderfully written, no other writer can match its Arabic prose. But if Muhammad was history's greatest master of Arabic, no one would be able to match his Arabic, right? So even if the Quran were truly unsurpassable, which it isn't, but even if it were, we could just attribute this to Muhammad's unsurpassable Arabic eloquence, couldn't we? In other words, Sheikh Qadi should be making the exact opposite claim here. He should be arguing that Muhammad's Arabic was awful and that the Quran's Arabic is wonderful, and therefore that the Quran couldn't have come from Muhammad. In fact, Muhammad's Arabic is apparently better than the Quran's Arabic. Sheikh Qadi regards Arabic with foreign words as impure.
Now the Arabs viewed the language of the cities as being corrupted. The Arabs viewed the city language as being changed. Why? Because what happens to any language, it gets influenced by other cultures.
The Quran contains numerous foreign words. So if Muhammad, as a toddler in the desert, learned pure Arabic, uninfluenced by foreign vocabulary, and the Arabic of cities like Mecca is corrupted because it's been influenced by foreign vocabulary, and the Arabic of the Quran has been influenced by foreign vocabulary, then the Arabic of the Quran is corrupted and is inferior to the Arabic of Muhammad when he was a four-year-old. A four-year-old's Arabic was superior to Allah's Arabic. Better luck next time, Sheikh Qadi. The only remotely plausible theodicy here would be some form of what's called a soul-building theodicy. Soul-building theodicies claim that God sometimes allows suffering because suffering can make us better, more virtuous people. Being in dangerous situations, for instance, can produce courage. Going through various trials can build endurance, and so on. So, how does being repeatedly orphaned make one a better, more virtuous person?
Being an orphan gives you many qualities that the Prophet ﷺ would need later on in his life. And when our Prophet ﷺ is deprived of a mother and father, automatically this makes the child more independent. It makes the child more mature, gives him wisdom. Also, going through these difficult times makes you understand and experience firsthand poverty, ruthlessness, living in a harsh environment. And generally speaking, this makes you more sensitive. By going through this traumatic time, our Prophet ﷺ developed that fondness, that softness, that mercy, that tenderness for not just orphans, but all those who are weak. And this is a necessary requirement for being a prophet. Once again, our Prophet ﷺ is going through tough times in order to be compassionate, in order to be merciful. And that is why there are so many ahadith about taking care of orphans. Our religion has it as a central pillar to take care of the orphan. And our Prophet ﷺ was an orphan. There is a divine wisdom. Nothing happens Allah has a plan behind it.
My goodness, listening to Sheikh Qadi, we might conclude that the best thing we can do for our children is abandon them. They may not like it, but it'll turn them into strong, independent, mature, sensitive, compassionate people. Now, what's wrong with Sheikh Qadi's claim that Allah needed to destroy so many of Muhammad's early relationships in order to make him mature and sensitive and compassionate? Well, there are multiple problems. One, Allah had Muhammad's heart miraculously cleansed twice during his life. Once when he was a child, once when he was an adult.
There is no other more relationship because Jibreel took it out. هَذَا حَظُّ الشَّيْطَانِ مِنْ He took it out. And then he washed the heart in a golden cup of Zamzam. This incident of taking the heart out and washing it occurred one more time, almost 45 years later.
Now, if your heart is miraculously cleansed of sin, aren't you going to be compassionate towards orphans? Did Allah really need to go the extra mile by orphaning Muhammad over and over again? Two, the Quran repeatedly commands Muslims to show kindness to orphans. Since Muhammad obeyed Allah's commands perfectly and had his heart cleansed of sin, wouldn't he have been compassionate towards orphans without being repeatedly orphaned? Also, if Muhammad was compassionate towards orphans due to his upbringing, and the Quran puts special emphasis on caring for orphans, doesn't the Quran once more seem like it comes from the mind of Muhammad? Here again, Yasir Qadi should have argued that Muhammad's upbringing made him cold and ruthless towards orphans, so that the Quran obviously must have come from someone else. Three, as we'll see in a future installment, Islam was detrimental to orphans because Islam abolishes adoption. Adopting an orphan into your family is one of the most loving and humane things you can ever do. But Allah and Muhammad abolished this practice so that Muhammad could have the own adopted son. So Allah clearly cares more about Muhammad's sexual gratification than he cares about orphans. Four, Sheikh Qadi radically distorts and misrepresents the impact of orphanhood on childhood development. There are negative impacts on education. As one study reports, The effect of a parent's death on children's education has been found to be severe. Children lose school time even before parents die. Many drop out of school. A higher proportion were too young to understand this negative experience, which unfolds more and more as they grow older, thus plunging them into deeper levels of depression. Orphanhood has a negative impact on IQ. Even though being raised by a foster family helps diminish this impact on girls, it doesn't diminish the impact on boys. IQ tests conducted on children between 4 and 5 years old revealed a difference between girls in foster care and those in an orphanage, but showed no difference in case of boys. Girls in foster care scored an average of 82, while those who remained at the orphanage scored only 70. On the other hand, boys scored an average of 60 regardless of whether they were fostered. The average IQ score in the general population is around 100. Orphanhood has a negative impact on brain development. Parents do a lot more than make sure a child has food and shelter, researchers say. They play a critical role in brain development. More than a decade of research on children raised in institutions shows that neglect is awful
for the brain. We're having some internet technical difficulties here. Let's take a break now, and as we come back, we'll resume with this in-depth psychoanalysis of Islam. We'll be right back after this short break.
Research and Auto Ordnance, the Firearms Group, with a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology. It's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Carr Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the history of the 1911, the Tommy Gun, to the best in compact concealed carry, Carr Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealment, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Carr Firearms Group, made in the USA. Visit Carr.com today. Carr Arms, Magnum Research, and Nets. The Carr Firearms Group, with a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology. It's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Carr Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the hit of the 1911, and the Tommy Gun, to the best in compact concealed carry. Carr Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealed, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Carr Firearms Group, made in the USA. Visit Carr.com today. Carr Arms, Mag Research, and Auto Ordnance. The Carr Firearms Group, with a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology. It's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Carr Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the history of the 1911 and the Tommy gun, to the best in compact concealed carry. Carr Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealment, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Carr Firearms Group, made in the USA. Visit Carr.com today. Arms, Magnum Research, and Auto Ordnance. The Carr Firearms Group, with a diverse product line that blends American craftsmanship with cutting-edge technology. It's no secret why gun enthusiasts choose Carr Firearms Group. From the Desert Eagle and Baby Desert Eagle made famous by Hollywood, the history of the 1911 and the Tommy gun, to the best in compact concealed carry, Carr Firearms Group is not only the first name in personal defense, it's a name that has earned the respect of gun enthusiasts around the world. Concealment, innovative technology, value, accuracy, and history. Carr Firearms Group, made in the USA. Visit Carr.com today.
And we are back. Welcome back to the King's Report this Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. I'm your host, Hyungjin Sean Moon, Second King of Chonibuk, and let's return back to The Psychology of Islam by David Wood, Part 2.
Childhood has a negative impact on brain development. Parents do a lot more than make sure a child has food and shelter, researchers say. They play a critical role in brain development. More than a decade of research on children raised in institutions shows that neglect is awful for the brain, says Charles Nelson, a professor of pediatrics at Harvard Medical School and Boston Children's Hospital. Without someone who is a reliable source of attention, affection, and stimulation, he says, the wiring of the brain goes awry. The result can be long-term mental and emotional problems. When Nelson first visited the orphanages in 1999, he saw children in cribs rocking back and forth as if they had autism. He also saw toddlers desperate for attention. They'd reach their arms out as though they're saying to you, "Please pick me up," Nelson says. So you'd pick them up and they'd hug you. But then they'd push you away and they'd want to get down. And then the minute they got down, they'd want to be picked up again. It's a very disorganized way of interacting with somebody. The odd behaviors, delayed language, and a range of other symptoms suggested problems with brain development, Nelson says. So he and other researchers began studying the children using a technology known as electroencephalography, EEG, which measures electrical activity in the brain. Many of the orphans had disturbingly low levels of brain activity. Instead of a 100-watt light bulb, it was a 40-watt light bulb, Nelson says. As the children grew older, the researchers were able to use MRI to study the anatomy of their brains. Once again, the results were troubling. We found a dramatic reduction in what's referred to as gray matter and in white matter, Nelson says. In other words, their brains were actually physically smaller. The scientists realized the cause wasn't anything as simple as malnutrition. It was a different kind of deprivation. A parent, or someone who acted like a parent. What about the moral characteristics of orphans? I haven't been able to find any studies suggesting that orphans are more sensitive or compassionate than non-orphans. From personal experience, I can say that my dad was an orphan. The number of times I ever heard him show any concern for orphans was somewhere in the ballpark of zero. I also noticed from thousands of conversations with inmates in correctional institutions that almost none of the inmates ever shared stories about their fathers. Many of them shared stories about their mothers, but almost no one shared stories about their fathers. Do you know why that is? Because their fathers weren't around when they were growing up. Shouldn't these young men with missing fathers have become more sensitive and compassionate than young men from two-parent homes? They should have, according to the Yasser Qadhi theory of child development. Instead, many of them wouldn't think twice about cutting your throat. Now, just to be clear, if you grow up without a father, or you grow up as an orphan, this doesn't mean that you're going to be less educated or less intelligent or less compassionate than anyone else. You might end up winning multiple Nobel Prizes. There are tons of variables involved. So the point here isn't about individuals. The point is that statistically, looking at large numbers, the impact of orphanhood tends to be negative in several important ways, which means that it's not something you should want to impose on children as part of their upbringing. But Muhammad was orphaned, and Sheikh Qadhi believes that Allah was in control of this. So Sheikh Qadhi has to see this as possible, and this leads him to present a rosy picture of orphanhood. Once again, however, I have more respect for Allah than the Muslims who believe in him. I say that I have more respect for Allah than Sheikh Qadhi does, because if we listen to Sheikh Qadhi, we have to conclude that Allah is completely ignorant of psychology. But if Allah created human beings and created our brains and wired us in specific ways, then Allah must know what he's doing. He must know the impact of taking away a child's father, then taking away his foster family, then taking away his mother, then taking away his grandfather. Allah knows what this will do to a child, and we know what this will do to a child, which means that we can know Allah's true intentions. Sheikh Qadhi believes that Muhammad's trials during childhood shaped his character.
So by putting the Prophet ﷺ through such difficult circumstances, this made him who he was. And he needed to be that man in order to be the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
So from an Islamic perspective, what did Allah want Muhammad to become? It makes no sense to say that Allah orphaned Muhammad repeatedly in order to make him more sensitive. Being repeatedly orphaned doesn't make you more sensitive. But as we discussed in part one, we do know the impact of losing a father or father figure at a young age. Based on the psychology of the defective father, we were able to predict that someone with Muhammad's childhood experiences would rebel against authority and tradition, would have a problem with father figures, and especially with viewing God as a heavenly father, and would have some difficulty forming normal relationships with other people. If statistically these tend to be the results of losing a father or father figure at a young age, wouldn't Allah know this? And if Allah knew this, can't we say that Allah's intention was to shape Muhammad into someone with these characteristics in order to promote Islam? Unlike Sheikh Qadhi, we're going to test our claims, and for the remainder of this discussion, we'll see if our hypothesis about Muhammad rebelling against authority and tradition is confirmed or disconfirmed. Let's start with a couple of passages from the history of At-Tabari. The History of At-Tabari, Volume 6, beginning on page 93. The Messenger of God proclaimed God's message openly and declared Islam publicly to his fellow tribesmen. When he did so, they did not withdraw from him or reject him in any way, as far as I have heard, until he spoke of their gods and denounced them. When he did this, they took exception to it and united in opposition and hostility to him, except for those of them whom God had protected from error by means of Islam. Notice, when Muhammad preached Islam, they did not withdraw from him or reject him in any way until he spoke of their gods and denounced them. So the Quraysh had no problem with Muhammad preaching Islam. They only objected to him denouncing their gods. What did they do about it? They went to his uncle, Abu Talib, and said, "Abu Talib, your nephew has reviled our gods, denounced our religion, derided our traditional values, and told us that our forefathers were misguided. Either curb his attacks on us or give us a free hand to deal with him, for you just as opposed to him as we are, and we will deal with him for you. Abu Talib gave them a mild answer and declined courteously, and they left him. The messenger of God continued as before, proclaiming the faith of God and summoning people to it. After a while, they complained again. Abu Talib, you are our elder and our chief, so give us justice against your nephew and order him to desist from reviling our gods, and we will leave him to his God. Here again, they have no problem with Muhammad preaching his view of God. They object to Muhammad reviling their gods, and their only request is that he stop reviling their gods. The tension builds, and in another passage, beginning on page 101, a Muslim asks a Muslim from Mecca about the worst attack by the Quraysh on Muhammad. This is the worst attack on Muhammad. I said to him, "What was the worst attack you saw by Quraysh upon the Messenger of God? Openly showed their enmity to him." He replied, "I was with them when their nobles assembled one day in the Hijr and discussed the Messenger of God. They said, 'We have never seen the like of what we have endured from this man. He has derided our traditional values, abused our forefathers, reviled our religion, caused division among us, and insulted our gods.'" Does that sound like rebellion against authority and tradition? "We have endured a great deal from him," or words to that effect. While they were saying this, the messenger of God suddenly appeared and walked up and kissed the black stone. Then he passed by them while performing circumambulation, and as he did so, they made some slanderous remarks about him. I could see from the messenger of God's face that he had heard them, but he went on. When he passed the second time, they made similar remarks, and I could see from his face that he had heard them, but again he went on. Then he passed them the third time, and they made similar remarks, but this time he stopped and said, "Hear, men of Quraysh, by him in whose hand Muhammad's soul rests, I have brought you slaughter." Muhammad promises to slaughter his own tribe. They were gripped by what he had said, and it was as though every man of them had a bird perched on his head. Even those of them who had been urging the severest measures against him previously spoke in a conciliatory way to him, using the politest expressions they could think of, and said, "Depart in true guidance, Abu al-Qasim. By God, you were never ignorant." The Prophet left, and the next day they gathered in the Hijr, and I was again present. They said to one another, "You were talking about the unpleasantness which you have endured and the things which Muhammad has done to you, but when he openly said something disagreeable, you shrank from him." While they were saying this, the messenger of God suddenly appeared, and they leapt upon him as one man and surrounded him, saying, "Is it you who says this and that, repeating what they had heard of his denunciation of their gods and their religion?" The Prophet said, "Yes, I am the one who says that." So he admits to reviling their gods and their religion. Then I saw one of them grabbing his cloak, but Abu Bakr stood in front of him, weeping and saying, "Woe upon you all! Would you kill a man because he says, 'My Lord is God'?" Then they left him, and that is the worst thing I ever saw Quraysh do to him. Think about this. The text says over and over again that the Quraysh had no problem with Muhammad believing in Allah alone and preaching Islam. They had a problem with Muhammad insulting their gods, reviling their religion, abusing their forefathers, and causing division. Muhammad did this for years, and they kept going to his uncle, asking Abu Talib to convince him to stop talking about their gods. In response, Muhammad promised to slaughter them. We just read it, not making this up. One of them grabbed his cloak, and Abu Bakr screamed, "Are you going to kill a man simply for believing in Allah?" Have you noticed that Islam often causes its adherents to interpret any objections to Islamic practices as simple objections to belief in Allah? "Hey, I have a problem with marrying 6-year-old girls and female genital mutilation and raping female captives and violently subjugating non-Muslims and terrorist attacks in general.
Why is David Wood persecuting us simply for believing in Allah?"
So, did Muhammad rebel against authority and tradition? Yes, the only exceptions were that he continued certain pagan practices, such as circling the Kaaba and kissing the black stone, but only because he could incorporate these pagan practices into his rebellion. But Muhammad wasn't satisfied with rebelling against authority and tradition. He also encouraged others to rebel against authority and tradition, unless the authority and tradition came from him. Of course, any prophet might say to his listeners, don't just believe what you believed, you need to put God first. But with Muhammad, this rises to the level of obsession, and the main obstacle to Islam turns out to be people trusting their fathers. Surah 2, verse 170. When it is said to them, the unbelievers, follow what Allah has sent down, they say, nay, we shall follow what we found our fathers following. What? Even though their fathers did not understand anything, nor were they guided? Surah 5, verse 104. And when it is said to them, come to what Allah has revealed and unto the messenger Muhammad, they say, enough for us is that which we found our fathers following, even though their fathers had no knowledge whatsoever and no guidance. Surah 7, verse 28. And when they commit an indecency, they say, we found our fathers doing this, and Allah has enjoined it on us. Say, surely Allah does not enjoin indecency. Do you say against Allah what you do not know? Surah 9, verse 23. O you who believe, do not take your fathers and your brothers for guardians if they love unbelief more than belief. And whoever of you takes them for a guardian, these it is that are the unjust. Surah 11, verse 109. So be not in doubt, O Muhammad, as to what these men worship. They worship nothing but what their fathers worshipped before them. And verily, we shall repay them in full their portion without diminution. Surah 31, verse 21. When they are told to follow the revelation that Allah has sent down, they say, nay, we shall follow the ways that we found fathers following. What, even if it is Satan beckoning them to the penalty of the blazing fire? Surah 34, verse 43. And when our clear verses are recited to them, they say, this Muhammad is only a man who wishes to hinder you from that which your fathers used to worship. This message about not trusting fathers was the message of all prophets, according to the Quran. Surah 43, verses 21 through 24. Or have we given them a book before it so that they hold fast to it? Nay, they say, we found our fathers on a course, and surely we are guided by their footsteps. And thus, we did not send before you any warner in a town, but those who led easy lives in it said, surely we found our fathers on a course, and surely we are followers of their footsteps. The warner said, what? Even if I bring you a better guide than that on which you found your fathers? They said, surely we are unbelievers in that with which you are sent. Notice, Allah never sent a prophet who didn't tell people not to trust their fathers. And the Quran gives us numerous examples of these former prophets. We read about the Prophet Hud's discussion with unbelievers in Surah 7, verses 70-71. They said, have you come to us that we may serve Allah alone and give up what our fathers used to serve? Then bring to us what you threaten us with, if you are the truthful ones. He said, indeed, uncleanness and wrath from your Lord have lighted upon you. What? Do you dispute with me about names which you and your fathers have given? Allah has not sent any authority for them. Wait then. I too, with you, will be of those who wait. When the Prophet Saleh preaches to the people of Thamud, they reply in Surah 11, verse 62, O Saleh, surely you were one amongst us in whom great expectations were placed. Do you now forbid us from worshipping what our fathers worshipped? Abraham speaks to his people in Surah 21. We read in verses 52 to 54, when he said to his father and his people, what are these images to which you are devoted? They said, we found our fathers worshipping them. He said, you and your fathers have been in manifest error. We find a similar passage in Surah 26, verses 70 to 76. When he, Abraham, said to his father and his people, what do you worship? They said, we worship idols, and to them we are ever devoted. He said, do they hear you when you call? Profit you or cause you harm? They said, nay, but we found our fathers doing so. He said, have you then considered what you have been worshipping, you and your fathers before you? In Surah 12, verse 40, Joseph says to his fellow prisoners in Egypt, if not him, you worship nothing but names which you have named. you and your fathers, for which Allah has sent down no authority. In Surah 11, verse 87, the Midianites respond to the prophet Shu'aib, presumably Jethro, O Shu'aib, does your prayer enjoin you that we should forsake what our fathers worshipped, or that we should not do what we please with regard to our property? In Surah 10, verse 78, Pharaoh and his chiefs reply to Moses, Have you come to turn us away from the ways we found our fathers following, in order that you and your brother may have greatness in the land? In Surah 14, verse 10, Moses tells the Jews about the message of the prophets before him. Their messengers said, Is there doubt about Allah, the maker of the heavens and the earth? He invites you to forgive you your faults and to respite you till an appointed term. They said, You are nothing but mortals like us. You wish to turn us away from what our fathers used to worship. Bring us, therefore, some clear authority. The main task of all prophets, according to Muhammad, the orphan with a psychological need to rebel against authority and tradition, seems to be convincing people not to listen to their fathers. This is interesting because the vast majority of Muslims only believe in Islam because it's what their parents taught them. Nevertheless, convincing people to rebel against their parents and culture usually doesn't go over too well. So, not surprisingly, Muhammad had to flee Mecca. The Meccans couldn't have been happier. Once he was gone, they could go on practicing their religion and traditions. Muhammad was safe hundreds of miles away in Medina. He and his followers could work and worship Allah and learn the Quran in peace. But Muhammad didn't want to live in peace, so he started robbing the Meccan caravans. Muhammad knew that the people of Mecca depended on these caravans. Anyone who had any money would invest it, hoping to get back something extra to feed their families. If the caravan didn't return, some people would starve. So Muhammad started attacking these caravans. The attacks eventually led to war with Mecca. Muhammad won the war when he conquered Mecca, seized the Kaaba, and smashed the 360 idols worshipped by the pagans of Arabia. His tribe, the Quraysh, was forced to submit to him. So, Muhammad attacked his own people theologically, socially, morally, economically, and militarily. And he won. Therefore, if you're a Muslim and you ask,
Why did Allah Azza wa Jal put three orphan situations, three traumatic trials, one after the other, upon our Prophet?
The correct answer from an Islamic perspective is not, I guess Allah wanted to make Muhammad more sensitive. The correct answer from an Islamic perspective is that Allah wanted to turn Muhammad into the ultimate weapon for destroying cultures, and in order to do that, he had to crush Muhammad emotionally and psychologically. But this isn't all that Allah wanted to do with Muhammad. In our next video, The Psychology of Islam, Part 3, Theology of the Fatherless, we'll see how Allah's psychological experiments on Muhammad led Muhammad to react violently to the Judeo-Christian view of God as our Heavenly Father. So, in X-Men movie terms, Allah is the theological equivalent of Dr. Xander Rice, director of Alkali Transigen, the company that creates the soulless Wolverine clone X-24 to annihilate its enemies. X-24 is the fourth experiment, which makes the prior experiments obsolete. Of course, in the Quran, Muhammad, the seal of the prophets, is the 25th prophet mentioned by name, so he should technically be Allah's X-25. Or if we go with P for prophet, he was Allah's P-25. For the sake of clarity, I'll refer to Muhammad as P-25 when we're discussing Allah's psychological experiments.
If Allah had willed, he could have had loving parents until he became a prophet, or at least until he became a young man, an adult. Allah has a plan. Allah has a plan.
There it is, part two of a fascinating investigation about the nature of Islam and its prophet, Muhammad. Let's take a short break, and we will be right back after this short break. Stay with us.
believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the world that never ends because he lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the sun away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen.
I'm alive because he lives.
Amen. Amen. Let my song join the world that never ends. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the sun away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive.
sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the world that never ends because he lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame.
Welcome back to the King's Report this Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. I'm your host, Hyungjin Sean Moon, the second king of Chunhyuguk. Going now to the top story on Drudge, Kim Jong-un crazed North Korean despot has Kim Jong-un's troops blow up U.S. aircraft carrier and shoot down bomber in propaganda video. Snaps from the secretive state's recent ballistic missile launches are shown alongside a haunting message. Let's go to this video.
To bring senior officials from North Korea over.
Harvard trained, nationally acclaimed.
Sunday, that preparations are already underway. It would not be an official state visit, just a meeting between some top Korean officials and former U.S. officials. But sources told the Washington Post it could be a signal that leader Kim Jong-un wants to be in touch with U.S. President Donald Trump's administration. If talks do get the green light, they would be the first of their kind in more than 5 years. For now, the White House has been quiet on the report.
Yes. Okay.
Claim for excellence in patient care. Dr. Enche Zama is saving lives in the community.
Switch the audio there. Kim Jong-un has released a propaganda video showing a U.S. aircraft carrier being blown up and bomber shot down in flames. Snaps from the secretive states. Recent ballistic missile launches are shown alongside a haunting message. A knife will be stabbed in the throat of the carrier, they say. Propaganda film shows aircraft carrier USS Carl Vinson being targeted. Comes days after Kim Jong-un threatened the U.S. with nuclear destruction. Here it is. Here is the video.
Ongat 핵전략 자산들을 긁어모아 총알받이 괴뢰 호전광들을 앞세우고 핵선제 타격에 열을 올리는 대양곤 놓은 전쟁 미치광이 미국이. 연례적이며 방어적이라던 외피마저 완전히 벗어던진 채 우리의 최고 전엄까지 걸고 감행되는 악명 높은 대려 암살 그 모든 훈련들 이는 우리에 대한 공공연한 선전포고. 무엄하구나. 무자비한 핵강타가 준비된 최종의 전략무력, 명실상부한 동방의 핵강국 앞에서 감히 자주권 수호 의지를 시험하려 들며 미국과 괴뢰들이 놀아대는 꼴들이 정말 가련하기 짝이 없구나. 그 끝을 알 수 없이 분출하는 무자비한 백두산 혁명가 항군의 힘 앞에 바다의 핵항공모함은 목줄기에 비수가 박혀 꿈틀거리다 나가 너부러질 변태 동물일 뿐 하늘의 비일비는 불선악기를 맞아 우스스 떨어져버릴 한갓 두나비일 뿐 상대 모르고 감히 벌려놓은 전쟁 불장난 우리의 자주권이 행사되는 용역에 튕기는 그 한 점 불꽃이 곧 미국의 멸망을 알리는 전주곡이 되리라. 지난 세기 50년대에는 비록 한 목소리의 도장을 찍을 놈이라도 있었지만 세계를 넘어 장약해온 우리의 분노 화산처럼 터져오르는 그날 임의의 시각에 임의의 지점에서 날아오르게 될 우리의 자랑스러운 주체탄 불소나기에 가까이에 있던 대양곤노에 있던 군수들은 가장 정확하고 가장 신속하게 가장 철저하게 지도 없이 죽탕치워지리라. 목숨 같은 자주권을 위해 교리의 통일을 위해 인류의 평화를 위해 미국이 휘두르는 폭제의 핵을 종이의 핵마치로 무자비하게 내리치어 부정의 못이 다시는 솟구치지 못하게 하리라. 정의로운 선군의 복음으로 교리의 머리 위에는 아름다운 통일의 무지개를, 인류의 머리 위에는 평화의 푸른 하늘 펼치어 가리라.
They're going to blow up the U.S. The U.S. Vincent, USS Carl Vinson, for the sake of world peace, they say. And they say for the sake of the beautiful rainbow of unification. That's what they say. This is the rainbow of unification of North and South to be under totalitarian rule. The rainbow of despotism and totalitarianism. Now, let's go to the Queen now for her breakdown and or feelings and thoughts of this type of propaganda video. Have you ever seen anything like this?
You know, actually, I never saw such a video that was made by North Korea, the propaganda video. You know, in Korea, the South Korea, they're very, they're... They became totally numb about, you know, this how North Korea react to this kind of war pumped up videos, because the language is like so, you know, I speak for I'm Korean, I'm a native Korean, so obviously I understand it, but I at the same time I cannot understand what they're saying. There's
they
a, so
like
much modifier.
Right?
Yeah, so much metaphor, and then so much how to say it's they like, embellishes their language, the pro-war language. It doesn't register to our brain.
It's almost they're trying
foreign.
To use poetic prose.
That's so true.
Right? They're trying to paint it in this propaganda poetic prose. So it doesn't sound like normal Korean at all.
It doesn't sound like normal Korean at all.
They use all these very strange words.
You know, one time when I talked with this North Korea expert, he told me a very interesting thing. He said, the reason they pumped up this war against and positioned America as an enemy, their ultimate enemy, and all these things, they actually do it not for not really to do the war, but they actually do it to maintain their citizen oppressed
control.
Yeah,
control.
So I think even if this war in a movie, the Korean South Korean especially sees as it's just regular routine, do their thing, and it's very they are very numb about the whole situation, and you know, especially now, it is actually time that Korea, the world situation around South Korea is like really rolling up into war situation. So at the same time, I feel very sad to see it, because the South Korea is totally, you know, not aware of it. But also, they've been doing it for 50 years, so it's more than 50 years.
So people are kind of numb to it.
It's so I can't really blame them. It's I kind of mixed the feeling when I see this.
Yeah. Well, that's a very, you know, here they are blowing. Here they are also shooting military tanks in the images. Because God forbid if North Korea would ever join the United States of Chun-il-guk, and have freedom and responsibility, and or even the United States under the U.S. Constitution, if they had democracy. God forbid if the people had choice and actually had the ability to decide the fate of their nation. Here they are here. Here are the pictures from the video, but interesting. They have these missile launches from the video. There they are, the missile launches. And look at this, it's very interesting here. This picture where they have Kim Jong-un, it's called Obojo, which means like giving a piggyback ride to one of the peasants or one of the military people who are basically a slave. And you can see, look at that, the military older gentleman that he's piggybacking. Look how they're crying. You see this? Look how they're weeping. As he's piggybacking him, look how they're weeping. And those other people around him are all crying and weeping. Do you see this, Emma? Can you see this? Now, as Koreans, in Korean culture, which is very hierarchical, it's like this image evokes in me, I can actually get what is happening here. You know what I'm saying? Whereas the Western person will see this like, what the heck is going on? He's picking back this guy and this guy's crying. They don't understand it because it's so horizontal here. But in Asia, where everything is so hierarchical, it's like that person cannot even believe that Kim Jong-un, who is like a more than a celebrity, right? He is like a god. That this god would come down and be so friendly with them and do something that you only do for your children and or do for your parents or whatever. And it shows a great kind of closeness in Korea when you say you abojo something, you somebody, you piggyback ride them. You give them a piggyback ride. In America, we don't have none of that kind of closeness associated with that. You know what I mean? But in Korea, the Korean language, the abojo, the nature of abojo means it's a very close. You only do that for your children.
Yeah, sure.
Because in Asia, you don't even touch each other. You know what I mean? You don't hug each other. You don't hug your in public. You don't even. It's you know, it was until the you know, maybe recently, you don't even hold your hands with your wife in public. You know what I'm saying? It's very culturally insensitive to even touch somebody. Whereas you have this god who they basically god descend down and he's giving a piggyback ride to one of his military people, but basically one of his slaves. And you can see them, they're weeping in gratitude. You see that? They're weeping in total gratitude. Now, on one respect, that is what Father talked about a lot of time in the heart of the preparation of the chosen people. That they are filled with Han, that they are filled with a desire to want to find Christ. Of course, Kim Jong-un is not Christ. But to have a overwhelming desire and emotional will to want to be close to God. Of course, that's the nature of all human beings. It's interesting, when I see this photo, it reminds me of even times that we had when in Korea, it was so weird because we would give people hugs and they would start weeping. Or Father would give people a person a hug and they would just start weeping before him. Father would acknowledge somebody and they would be just so overtaken, you know. I guess it's not really that much different when Koreans see Westerners and they like are worshiping Beyonce. And you have these dumb bimbo girls up in the front, literally weeping and wailing, seeing Michael Jackson. You know what I mean? That seems very wacky for a Korean, unless they're really super young and they're a teeny bopper, and they already do that. They do that culture for the stars in Korea, right? But at least from maybe 30 and 40s and above, I'm talking about in age, when they see that, it's really wacky. You know what I mean? It's a very strange phenomenon. But seeing this, you can see these pictures. It's so weird. It's such a weird, surreal thing to be able to look at what they're doing. Here's another picture down here. This is Japan now. Look at that, Japan. We showed that video. Yesterday's King's Report was shut down because we showed this video. But here's Japan actually practicing. They have all the young kids practicing for nuclear attack. Trump, members of the administration have been talking tough on North Korea since the Republican took office back in January. Last week, the President and Secretary of State Rex Tillerson announced the policy of strategic patience was over and refused to rule out military action. He said the diplomatic and other efforts of the past 20 years to bring North Korea to a point of denuclearization has failed, so we have 20 years of approach. And that includes a period in which the U.S. provided $1.35 billion in assistance to North Korea as an encouragement to take a different pathway. He added, if they elevate the threat of their weapons program to a level we believe requires action, the option is on the table. There are Japanese school children at the Hokuyu Elementary School listening to instructions of a missile evacuation drill. Look at those kids. I mean, they're getting filled with fear now. Meanwhile, fearing imminent attack, Japan has begun staging mass evacuation drills. The first exercise of this kind was saw civilians, young and old, scrambling for cover as air raid sirens wailed. Previously reported, Japanese civil defense officers have published pamphlets outlining emergency measures in the event of nuclear war. It's not the first time North Korea has released a video threat in the U.S. In 2013, a similar video was made showing a nuclear attack on the White House. Tim mentioned that. And in other dystopian, look at Jeff Bezos, everybody, looking creepy and happy, piloting a giant mechanical robot. That's Jeff Bezos, the billionaire, elitist, progressive, liberal lunatic. Adding to this growing pile of evidence, the world is slowly transitioning into a cyberpunk. A billionaire entrepreneur with a sideline in building space rockets has been shown off piloting a 13-foot-tall robot. CEO of Amazon and fifth richest person in the world. There it is, right? Fifth richest person. There we go. Jeff Bezos got behind the wheel joysticks of the robot retailing giant's annual robotic conference. He tweeted out picture above early this morning saying, I just got to pilot an awesome and huge robot thanks to Hanguk Mire Technology, which is a Korean company. Other attendees videoed the event, and Bezos can be seen waving the robot's arm, asking, why do I feel so much like Sigourney Weaver? Reports that he then told the crowd to bow down before your new king and master Metal Jeff are unsubstantiated. And here is a robot with Jeff Bezos in it moving around. As he moves his arms inside this dystopian sci-fi power, arrogant, psychopathic, predatory, elitist, who is part of the Bilderberg Group, Davos Group, 100% for world government, 100% for regulating and restricting human being and human activity, uses his money to fund the communist regimes in America, which are the Democratic Party mainly, and the world governance of communism over the world. Bezos showing the robot off in Mars. Now look at this actual video from the actual robot in testing in Korean laboratories. It doesn't only move its arms, that thing can actually walk as well as this video shows. There is the probably thousands of pounds heavy robot with steel, cybertronic, hydraulic muscle systems. Can you imagine? That is now walking. That is now being tested in these labs. You can see how we are moving towards a technological robotic future, which the elite have been talking about, which really is their cult and religion. They believe they will merge with robots and become super powerful, and then be able to basically eliminate and or human farm the rest of humanity, as they are the inheritors of this more powerful technology, which will give them super abilities. There is a robot moving around, walking around. Normal people shouldn't see this. this is quite disturbing, as RoboCop's vision of that dystopian hell is now coming true. Of course, people in Peace Police, Peace Militia, and people who are actually alphas and have their epigenetics unlocked see this and say, ooh, that's dangerous. Those predatory beta predators, super predators, wolves, will try to use that to oppress the normal human sheepdog alphas. And so we have to come up with contingency plans, if we had to fight such a thing, on how to destroy it. That's, of course, the reason why the elites hate you when you are armed, when you know how to use weapons, when you strategically can plan with other people who can bring these kind of robots down. We've of course shown video on the King's Report of other hydraulics and other types of machinery that is extremely nightmarish. Boston Robotics, is that the company? Boston Robotics, is that the company? Also owned by Google. That one is owned by Google. See how these elitists, they're all into, they invest their money into these dystopian companies that are pursuing these nightmarish dreams where they can gather superpower and or they can order these robots to do their bidding upon a whim. And robots will never say no unless they create AI, which will eventually replace human beings and or see human beings and destroy human beings. In other news on Drudge, real-life RoboCops will soon replace human police. Robot police were once sci-fi fantasy, but soon the real thing will be patrolling the streets of Dubai. While the original RoboCop in 1987 film, a superhuman cyborg law enforcer, could hunt down murderous criminals, the real-life version will be tackling more straightforward misdemeanors. There's the one from the movie. The first robot police officer will be on patrol in the wealthy United Arab Emirates city by May this year, police have confirmed. It is a wealthy place, but it's also a place that is under Sharia law. When we were in Dubai, we went to Dubai with Father, and we were told by people who frequented Dubai that you'll have these young Muslim women who are under Sharia law. They will go onto a plane to Europe dressed in their burqas and hijabs. There you can actually reveal your face, so you wear a hijab. But they're in their hijabs, in their burqas, get on the plane. They will go into the bathroom on the way out of the UAE, going towards Europe. They will come out with mini skirts and bikini tops. This is how much they really want to be under Sharia law, Tim. You see that? This is they really want to wear their burqa. Because they will go to Europe. They will wear get in the bathroom. They will come out with literally mini skirts on and cut off jeans or whatever they want to wear. And they're going to Europe to go partying, disco clubbing, drugging, drinking, all the stuff that they can't do in the Sharia law based countries. They take vacations to Europe so they can do all that stuff. I remember we were going up the tallest building before the elevator. There's this escalator, and there's a Muslim woman there that is basically taking you up there to the elevator, and she was going up the escalator. And Umma, you saw it too, right? She's wearing this black hijab and this black robe all the way down her ankles. Now, when she goes up the stairs, we saw her ankles and shoes. She was wearing red hot stilettos, like 5-inch heels under that burqa. You saw that, right? You saw that. Yes. Remember that? Yeah, we laughed so hard because she's wearing stilettos under that burqa. Oh my gosh. Was it Rebel Media? Was it Gavin McGinnis? And he was making a joke saying, that's like a heaven for men. Like, you know, we get to see our, you know, it's like a, he's saying it's a strip show every night. They have to wear their burqas. And then when they come home, oh, you've only been able to see a woman's ankle. And when your wife comes home.
That's the sexist, the poor ankle. ankle, woman's ankle is
that yes, Arabian men yeah. are crazy about yeah. the size of women's ankles. They actually like big ankles. This is what my Arabian, when I took a course at Harvard about the Arabian Nights and Islamic history, the teacher, who was an expert, said Arabian men are crazy about big ankles. At least traditionally, I don't think now anymore, because you know there's
you mean swollen ankles. Or?
No, big elephant-like ankles.
I don't understand how an ankle is big or small.
It's more they can't see any skin. They can't see any skin, so they see more skin. Anyways, that's what he said. Okay, but I'm sure it's different now because the Arabian men are watching porn and they're watching skinny women everywhere. So, but. Anyway, so the first robot police officer will be on patrol in wealthy UAE. Members of the public will be able to report crimes to the multilingual police using a touchscreen on its chest. On its chest. There it is, looking all friendly and nice. And you'll be able to report. You'll be able to report crimes to this multilingual police officer who actually has legal power. See, it always starts at this nice looking thing. That doesn't look so nice, by the way. That looks like that can hurt you. But it always starts off as if it is nice and friendly. That actually looks pretty scary. Look at that thing. That looks like Jason from Friday the 13th or something. See, it's getting more scary. It used to be the first ones that they put off were little R2-D2 robots, okay, that were giving you tickets. Now it's getting more scary. Look at that. The next prototype, this is version 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever it is. Look at that. That's now looking like Jason from Friday the 13th. What is it going to do to detain you? And when they become more and more nefarious and more nightmarish, as the ones we saw, can you imagine big robots policing the streets? That is so dangerous, especially when the citizens are disarmed. Wow! Can you imagine getting in control of all those control systems? If you're the super predator elite and you got control of that system, you can go destroy anybody you want with robots? This is too much, folks. This is not the direction we want to move in. Very, very dangerous. On other news, man wears MAGA hat in New York City as a social experiment. Predictable results ensue. New York Post reporter Dean Balsamini wore a MAGA hat around Manhattan, Brooklyn, and New York. Was cursed and condemned. That's not surprising news. Also an exclusive here we want to cover. 9/11 families. 9/11 victim families sue Saudi Arabia, accused the U.S. ally of complicity in the terrorist attacks. Amazing, amazing, amazing. New York, in a stunning lawsuit seeking to hold Saudi Arabia accountable for 9/11, the families of 800 victims have filed a lawsuit accusing the Saudis of complicity in the worst terror attacks on American soil. But the NIST and the National Institute of Sciences Technology told you, because they're government-run, that Saudi Arabia had nothing to do with it, and it had to be Iraq. Well, that's what George Bush told you, but NIST told you that it was because of the flames of the aircraft that the entire steel buildings were melted and fell down at the speed of gravity. Give me a break! You gotta be brain dead to believe that. The legal action filed in federal court in Manhattan details a scenario of involvement by Saudi officials who are said to have aided some of the hijackers before the attacks. 15 of the 19 hijackers were Saudi nationals, and we went and killed Iraqis for that. While Vice President Cheney brought his oil company in and stole Iraqi oil, billions of dollars. 15 of the 19 hijackers were Saudis, and we went off on an Iraqi killing spree to get their oil. True Father was totally against the Iraqi war. I've been railing about this for years. Everybody thought we were nuts when we're talking about 9/11. We brought Dr. Richard Gage in to show the evidence. And then Trump came out later. See that on the macro? Trump comes out later bringing out 9/11. Now with the declassified information and more will come out. Look at this. 15, now 800 of these families, thank God, are now suing the Saudi Arabian government. Fantastic. The document details how officials from Saudi embassies supported hijackers Salam al-Hazam and Khalid al-Bidar 18 months before 9/11. The officials allegedly helped them find apartments, learn English, and obtain credit cards and cash. The document stated that the help them learn how to blend into the American landscape. The suit also produces evidence that the officials in the Saudi embassy in Germany supported lead hijacker Mohammed Atta. It claims a Saudi official was in the same hotel in Virginia with several hijackers the night before the attacks. Many of the revelations in the lawsuit are called findings of an FBI investigation into the terrorist attacks. The suit filed by aviation law firm Crenler and Crenler claims some of the hijackers had special markers in their passports identifying them as Al-Qaeda sympathizers. But they were allowed in, you see that? The lawsuit asserts that the Saudi royals, who for years have been trying to curry favor with fundamentalists to avoid losing power, were well aware of the funds from Saudi charity being funneled to Al-Qaeda. Aviation attorney Jim Kreidler told PIX 11 News the charities were alter egos of the Saudi government. The lawsuit spells out how money was transferred from charities in Saudi Arabia to the terror group. Charities, the lawsuit claimed, fronted for Al-Qaeda, include the Al-Haramain Islamic Foundation organization designated by the U.S. as a sponsor of terrorism. Kleinler maintains that there was a direct link between all the charities and Osama bin Laden, and that they operated with the knowledge of Saudi officials. No surprise. And we were just mocked and scorned and made fun of for telling the truth because these stupid liberal lunatics and the frauds of the family fraud, who are also liberal lunatics, who are in the cult of the current satanic political Satanism, all they did was mock us when we brought out this truth. President George Bush and Barack Obama had resisted efforts to hold Saudi Arabia accountable. The kingdom is a key ally against Iran, and its oil interests are important to the United States. Father was 100% against Iraqi war after 9/11. He said, do not go to war in Iraq because of 9/11. He knew. He said that if we went to war, America would be destroyed. Last September, Congress ordered an Obama veto to pass JASTA, Justice Against Sponsors of Terrorism Act, that would allow Americans to take legal action against countries that supported terrorism. Yes, because Obama was trying to cover for the same CIA coup that he had done from the Bushes. Bush, Clinton, Obama, Mini Bush, Baby Bush, and Daddy Bush. All of them were related to the CIA. Not saying that all in the CIA are bad, but there is a deep state in the CIA that is a coup and working with the top political Satanists in the world. We reported on this years ago, getting cursed and mocked. Now it's coming out that it's true. Thank God a lawsuit is finally being done and is now legal to be done. Obama made it illegal to sue them. Thank God now it's legal to sue them. The lawsuit is a demonstration of a commitment of the 9/11 families to hold Saudi Arabia accountable for its critical role in the 9/11 attacks. Wow. Wow, wow, wow. That is fantastic. They need to be exposed and destroyed. In another exposed by the rebel media, Muslim woman called Nazi scum by leftists. Let's go to this clip.
Silence is deadly. What does that mean?
It means that we have the right to speak out against any ideology that we want to and criticize it for the crimes that it commits, what people commit in its name. In Islam, a lot of Christians in different countries and other Muslims are persecuted because they're different. And we should be, and it's done in the name of religion. And if we don't speak out against them, then they're killed.
Are you from the Islamic world yourself,
yes,
ma'am?
Yes, I am.
Okay, which country would that be?
I'm from Pakistan.
Oh, okay, then. So you've seen, I guess, the dark side of Sharia in your home nation, then?
Absolutely. My family members have seen people accused of blasphemy law tied to the back of cars and dragged through the streets and killed that way. There's a woman, Asia Bibi, she's been in jail for 7 years because someone falsely accused her of blasphemy. And there's a Christian girl who's a refugee. She was accused of blasphemy and she escaped with her life here in Canada. And can you imagine how she feels when something similar to the blasphemy law that she escaped from is like being implemented here in Canada?
And what's incredible is that, I mean, you've lived through this. You've seen it with your own eyes, and yet you have these predominantly white Canadians that are having
white
a counter-protest about what you're doing,
kids.
And they're calling people like you and others
Spoiled
here racist,
kids.
Bigots, Islamophobes. What's going on?
Well, the problem is they're not very intelligent. They're not well-educated, and they're not informed about the atrocities that
they're
happen in different
posturing.
Parts of the world. We come to Canada for
they're
a better life. We want to leave
postures.
That world behind. And we want to celebrate the beauty and the values of this country. And we don't want that horrible, horrible, draconian laws to follow us here. Sorry.
So what can they possibly say to you when you point out, listen, I'm originally from Pakistan. I've seen the dark side of Sharia. Why are you campaigning against people that are standing up for freedom of speech?
Well, when they call me fascist and they call me a white supremacist, I tell them...
They call you
me a white supremacist. Last time I was here, they're calling me a Nazi scum and a white supremacist. And
white
I'm like, I'm not. How can I be racist against my own people? And they say, it doesn't matter. You still are. And I want to say to them that I'm standing up for my women, my sisters that have died, my sisters that are in jail, the Safiya girls.
Yes,
they were Afghani Muslims, and they were killed because their parents thought they were too westernized. Canada is a beautiful country. I was born in Canada. I went back to Pakistan many times. My parents are from there. My family still lives there. And my family,
real
it's just a horrible thing. They don't understand. They'll
the
never understand until they live there.
The
they won't even last one day under Sharia
Islam.
Law.
Like what you just saw, then click subscribe below and never miss it.
Okay,
another
enough one. Of that. In a article on Breitbart, Scholar, white people acknowledge privilege to make themselves feel good. Avoid addressing racism. Scholar Claire Luckert argues in a new work that white people who acknowledge their privilege are less likely to engage in actual anti-racism efforts. In her work, Unhappy Confessions, The Temptation of Admitting to White Privilege, recent Emory graduate and Elon University scholar Claire Luckert argues that acknowledgement of white privilege or racism are pleasurable to enact, but ultimately reinforce white people's feelings of goodness and allow them to avoid addressing this racism. You see this? In the abstract for her work, Lockhart explains how an admission of white privilege could lead to a complacency that leads individuals away from anti-racist activism. I argue that because such admissions are conscious attempts to address unconscious habits, they are unhappy speech acts, and contrary to their implied aims. Admission of white privilege or racism can be conceptualized as Foucauldian, confessions that are pleasurable to enact, but ultimately reinforce white people's feelings of goodness and allow them to avoid addressing this racism. I ground my argument in Shannon Sullivan's analysis of white privilege and Sarah Ahmed's critique of confessions of racism privilege to show that in addition to doing no anti-racist work at the moment of saying, these confessions actually reify white privilege deeper into the unconscious and make it harder to address. Wow, wow, wow. This very good. Lockhart's Twitter account has now been set to private, tweeted on March 1st that she frequently would interrupt white students in her courses to encourage minority students to speak up. New favorite thing, interrupting white dudes in my class to say, I think students want to join the conversation. So white people are saying that are acknowledging their white privilege actually goes to reinforce racism. And that they do it to feel good about themselves. They do it because they're more than pressured to get social reward for saying, yes, we're privileged, yes. Everybody says, oh, you're such a good white child. And so they do it, they're morally posturing, faking, to get the social rewards from being, in their mind, humble, but really they're posturing. And psychologically what's happening is that they're reinforcing racial values. And then they're less likely to actually become, to go out and be active against real racism. Especially when it contradicts the narrative that only white people are racist. You have Hispanics with La Raza who are totally racist. You have Chinese, you have Koreans that are completely racist. You have blacks that can be completely racist. racism is not to one group, the white people. The fact that the top Bilderberg members, the top Bilderberg Davos group, world governance people are white, doesn't mean all white people are evil and want to do what they want to do. The fact of the matter is that all Chinese, because they're ruled by the Chinese elite who harvest their organs, who make them work in sweat factories and never put it on the media, who give their citizens ratings, avatar ratings, on how well you treat and praise the government, make all Chinese people bad. They are being oppressed by tyrannical, snot-nosed Chinese. Predators. You see, it doesn't have to do with race. It's not the issue with race. You can have people of any race, creed, and religion, and color, and sex be evil. The point is between the normal person and the predator class. The predator class is psychologically the psychotic class, which is 5 to 10% of the population. The sociopathic class being about 30 to 40%, according to the top psychologists in the world. And you have the normal people who are about 50%. What happens in Chenyugug is the sociopathic class finds no incentives of following the psychopathic class. So the sociopathic class, 30, 40%, join the normal people and then become 80, 90%. Meanwhile, the predator class, who are trying to still get into power, are relativized because they cannot concentrate money, power, and murder and guns to themselves. Because in Chenyugug, all peoples will have those powers. Territory sovereignty and the means to defend it. So what's happening? Then you are isolating the psychopathic predator class. You are limiting them. There are no social incentives or rewards to serve them. And they remain in their prison as the servants of humanity. Not those who get to rule over us and swindle and tongue-tie and lie and get their way into centralized power as politicians and or big lobbyists and then use that power to regulate everybody out of existence and into a totalitarian, despotic, dystopian hell. But a very new, interesting work by scholar Lockhart, delving into white people's white guilt and their social reward mechanisms that are operating when they are acknowledged, when they socially admit their white privilege while really not standing up against racism. Very interesting article. An exclusive House Freedom Caucus last minute Ryan Care amendments too little too late. We're gonna skip this break. We only have 10 more minutes to go. A spokesman for the House Freedom Caucus told Breitbart News that technical and medical Medicare-related changes to Ryan Care bill up for a House floor vote will not stop the bill from defeat. The amendments offered by Republican leadership do little to address the serious concerns of House conservatives, says Alyssa Farah, the caucus communication director. At this time, the bill does not have the votes to pass, she said. The Freedom Caucus will continue to work with the House colleagues, the Senate, and the White House to find a path forward that works for the American people. Now, Ryan Care, it is going to get passed. Okay, now it's better than Obamacare, but it's not as good as Rand Care, Rand Paul Care. Paul Care and Trump Care would be so much better. But Trump is in a situation now where he knows that he has to pass this through in order to get to the tax issues in order to the normal person's taxes. This is, of course, him allying with Paul Ryan and Ryan Care is a huge mistake. Ryan Care is simply Obamacare light. And it's all the personal mandates which force you to buy different type of insurance that you're not covered under. It still has all the taxes, the hidden taxes in there. Senator Rand Paul offered an incredible breakdown, which we covered about 2 weeks ago, on Ryan Care's bill, on the Ryan Care bill. Trump should be following Rand Paul, but he knows if he does so, the Rhino Republicans will stop it. And they will allow the Obamacare to implode the economy because that is what it was designed for. It was designed to work in cahoots with the insurance companies and the central government freaks to implode America's economy. And that would be the trope where in which they would say, that's why need international governance and or bank or bailouts from the IMF, Bank of International Settlements, etc. So we have a real huge mistake by Trump now with going along with the Ryan Care. His sort of explanation for that is that, hey, we got to hurry up and get this bill passed. At least it's better than the Obamacare that we had, even though it's a little bit Obamacare light. It's better than what we had. Not really, Trump. A little better, okay, but not really. And then he wants to get onto stimulating the economy again and trying to save this economic collapse, catastrophe that's coming down the road. With the lowering of taxes, with getting the people back into labor pool, with bringing jobs back, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Trump's visit is significant because taking advice, fellow, it demonstrates the president's commitment to right, but it could also be read as Trump's attempt to inoculate himself from the charge that he did not do enough to help the speaker if Ryan Care is defeated. Of course, Trump has tweeted out very clearly that he supports Rand Paul's bill. That was about 2 weeks ago. But he is cozying up to Ryan now to get this bill at least passed through so that there's some progress there and then he can jump to tax reform. But it is a serious, serious error, and it is a serious backtrack from his campaign promises about abolishing Obamacare, and the Republicans as well have been saying that for the last 8 years. Ted Cruz is was at a very large event saying, even he's saying, we should get rid of Obamacare. And he was one of the big traitors. Al Franken says, Gorsuch represents ideology that has already infected the bench. Look at these liberal lunatics, these freak predators. Look at them. Look at them. Look at them just seething and frothing at the mouth that their power is fading away under Trump and that he's returning sovereignty back. Oh boy, he's got to hurry up and push for the national concealed carry law. We have other news on that. Where is that? Saying that these liberal lunatics saying that the NRA is a terrorist organization. Extremist organization. There it is. Senator Feinstein. Oh, yes, the total demonic political Satanist Feinstein at Gorsuch confirmation saying that NRA is an extremist organization. Of course, the NRA was created to help black people fight the Ku Klux Klan. You remember that, Feinstein, you white supremacist racist? The NRA was trying to arm black people so that their wouldn't be raped, ravaged, and pillaged by the Ku Klux Klan and the Democratic Party. Oh, but you hate that. So you hate that. You want the blacks and the minorities to be under your rule. You want them to be disarmed, empowered, be filled with drugs, fighting in gangs. Keep those black market prices up. You need your war on drugs, right? Keep them fighting each other, killing each other off. Keep Planned Parenthood in there, murdering 54% of the black young children who can't even be born. Keep it going, Democrats. Keep the minorities getting killed. They'll never be able to realize what you're doing. No, now the minorities can get it. You see, we start getting what you're doing to the communities of the minorities. We see how important the freedom of arms and guns are to minorities. How essential it is to not be bullied and be pressured and be forced and coerced by predators like Feinstein to obey all the totalitarian, oppressive laws that they create. North Korea, to Tillerson, we are ready for any war the U.S. would like. Judge Neil Gorsuch promises senators he will uphold the Constitution as written. I wouldn't say he's as constitutional as Scalia, but he is way better than any of the leftist lunatics that could be put in. He has rave reviews from Judge Napolitano, who is excellent. Judge Jeanine also. Pirro on Fox, who is excellent. They give him high regards, so he is certainly a constitutionalist. Certainly he is for Second Amendment rights and protecting Second Amendment rights for the citizens these United States of America. Limbaugh on Comey hearing. Message to Trump is stop the drain, the swamp stuff, or face impeachment. Monday on his national syndicated radio, Rush Limbaugh maintained a House Intelligence Committee hearing that featured testimony from FBI Director James Comey and NSA Director Michael Rogers was meant to send a message to President Trump and his administration. Limbaugh argued that although there were some good questions from Republicans during the meeting, it was meant to be a warning shot at Trump, allow Washington Republicans to run the town or face possible impeachment. These hearings today, what happened last week and week before that, what happened during the transition period, what all of this explained simply by saying, look at how terrified they are in Washington, New York establishment of Donald Trump and draining the swamp. The never-Trumpers on both sides of the aisle, these are the conservative never-Trumpers today celebrating over the fact that Comey made it official that there's an investigation of Trump and colluding with the Russians. Wow, that they're going to find something great there. Top news on InfoWars. Where is it? Intelligence hearing reveals no Trump-Russia connections. Democrats' latest continued attempt to derail Trump administration not working. Top intel chiefs testified at House Intelligence Committee here on the Hill Monday over allegations that Russia meddled in the U.S. electoral system in the 2016 campaign. The United States House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence Chairman Devin Nunes made clear during his opening statement that the committee needs to find out what actions Russia undertook during the 2016 campaign. In his address, Mr. Nunes referred to the Russian news outlet RT as propaganda network and admitted that it's possible that other surveillance methods were used on Trump and associates. National Security Agency head Admiral Mike Rogers told the committee that the intel community has been aware for some time the direct connections between RT and government, such as monetary flow. Likewise, FBI Director James Comey testimony fell short whenever any sensitive questions arose, making his answers rather brief and stale. I've been authorized by the Department of Justice to confirm that the FBI, as part of our counterintelligence mission, is investigating the Russian government efforts to interfere with the 2016 presidential election. That includes investigating any links between individual associates with the Trump campaign and the Russian government, etc. The NSA head explained to the committee how, in most cases, the making of a U.S. person's name and documentation is usually done with a generic entry, such as U.S. person 1, 2, which typically keeps the person of interest unidentified. Representative Trey Gowdy also expressed his concern during the hearings in regards to an unauthorized publication of classified information by domestic news agencies. The unauthorized dissemination of publication of classified and otherwise legally protected information is punishable by up to 10 years in prison, Gowdy said. According to Gowdy, only the Department of Justice, along with the CIA, FBI, and NSA can unmask U.S. persons' names, and leakers should be held accountable. FBI Director Comey said he didn't want to confirm such classified information had hit the press from anyone inside, but made it clear such actions are criminal. Additionally, the committee spoke about political, operative, and frequent guests on the Alex Jones show, Roger Stone, who may have been target of surveillance due to the alleged connections to the hacker Guccifer 2.0 and his foreknowledge on the Podesta email leaks. So again, the intelligence hearings reveals no Trump and Russia connections again. Russia says to the U.S., in the response to the U.S., missile defense poses deep risk to security of Asia. The U.S. global ballistic missile defense poses a deep risk to the security of the region, declares Sergei Lavrov, Russian foreign minister, after meeting with Japanese officials in Tokyo. Lavrov specifically denounced the THAAD missile system America is installing in South Korea as a response completely out of proportion to the North Korean threat. He said the United States was pumping arms into the region. Tokyo has been thinking about asking the United States to pump a THAAD missile system into Japan, especially since the recent launch of 4 ballistic missiles toward the Japanese coast stoked fears that Pyongyang might be capable of swarm attacks or saturation launches that would overwhelm Japan's missile defenses, etc. At the end of the day, Lavrov said, If the reality unfolds in the way that South Korea's national security and the economy were damaged because of that, not because of the North Korean issue, that it's not really a national situation, is it? Choi Chung-gun, an advisor to front-running presidential candidate Moon Jae-in said over the weekend. The economic damage Choi referred to is coming mostly from an enraged China. Sergey Lavrov's comments in Tokyo are a warning of national security damage that will be heard clearly in Seoul. Again, tensions in Asia on this day. Forbes magazine says Iran cool travel destination for 2017. Visitors must adapt to Sharia law and customs. Muslim woman called Nazi scum. We showed that video. Big Bang Theory star confronts leftists for ignoring abuse of women. This is actually a woman who cares about women. Look at that. Mayim Bialik, who is that woman here? She is a Zionist. She believes that Israel should have a state. Is making headlines for calling out Linda Sarsour, a Palestinian activist and organizer of the Women's March, and she's opponent over her comments on feminism. Finally, some in Hollywood with a conscience are attacking some of these hypocritical Pharisee Sharia law proponents like Linda Sarsour, and attacking them and calling them. Bialik quotes saying many Muslim countries perpetrate atrocities against women, including female genital mutilation, forced marriages, child brides, systematic abuse of women by the justice system, revenge, rape, and honor killing, she added. Why is Israel held to a standard none of these are held to? Whose offenses are more extreme? As a feminist Zionist, I can't believe I'm being asked to choose or even defend my religious, historical, and cultural identity. The left needs to re-examine the microscope they use to look at Israel. And we all need to take a step back and remember we are stronger together, women, men, lovers of peace, and lovers of freedom and justice. She was recently arrested outside of Trump Tower in New York while protesting the 45th president, has not yet responded to Bialik. And of course, a video by showing the brainwashed by Infowars.com, showing the brainwashed social justice warrior and having them triggered, just the lunacy that happens when they showing that they are mentally disturbed and are part of a cult.
The apparatus of this country is about to be handed over to scum, who are beholden to scum, Russian scum.
Please listen. If you don't, if you won't, if you fail to understand, then the same incredible terror that's menacing me will strike at you!
The goal of all life is survival. Sleep. Sleep. Sleep.
Oh my god! Lock the door!
They're coming! Help! Help! They're coming! They're coming! Listen to me!
No,
listen!
Help me!
You're an expert in danger. Please listen to me. Something terrible. Please. You're next. Here they are. They're already here. Come. You're next. They're coming. They're coming.
Sleep. The seed is planted. Sleep. Sleep. Terror grows.
Wake up. Get you when you sleep. Sit up.
Invasion of the body snatchers.
All of a sudden, they're growing like parasites. Is it contagious? It looked right at me.
You need to get out.
You're looking at it as if it was human. It was not human.
The classic fear begins to grow.
We're being cornered.
In a modern masterpiece of science fiction.
They're barricading the street.
Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
Another wonderful, funny, satirical piece by InfoWars. They're very famous for doing that. Oh, we didn't cover the story. Meet Silicon Samantha. AI sex robot has a functioning G-spot and can switch between family and sexy mode. There is the sex doll with the founder, Sergey, what is his name? Santos, the perverted European guy who is fondling a robotic, you know, sex toy. Oh my goodness. This is what we have become, folks. This is what we have become. This is the fake culture that they want you to be a part of. This is the fake, pathetic, anti-human, human replacing robotic, technotronic, futuristic, dystopian, RoboCop, AI-infused hell that will replace human beings as the apex of creation. No, they will replace human beings, period. And this is the arrogance of these Satanists. They don't even know what trap they're walking into. They're walking into their own destruction, yet they're so filled with the elixir of power and the drug and addiction of central governance that they are actually seeking this transcendence, seeking this transhuman, is what they call transhumanism or transhuman futurism. The real human beings on this earth must rebel against these things. And yes, we can use technology, but technology is supposed to be a servant. It is not meant to be used by the predator class to oppress human beings, which it is always used for. Every advantage that the predators will use, will get, they will use against you and your family and your loved ones. Do you understand that? It is time for the kingdom of God, and not only the kingdom of God, but others to be brought into the kingdom so that they are empowered to be the true human beings that God created them to be fruitful, multiply, and have dominion of creation. To have a true relationship with Christ, the center and the creator of the universe, the one greater than anything that these idiots can think of. He is the one who gives us life, who fills us with power and identity. For we are children of God. We are sons of God and brides of Christ. We are men and women connected to Him for eternity. We are the progeny, the fruit of Jesus Christ in His second coming. We are the inheritors of this world. We are the co-heirs with Christ in His kingdom. We are the kings and queens of Chanilguk, the kingdom of God. Stands with the King of Kings and His actual kingship on this earth. Be infused with the true identity of God on this day, Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. We thank you for joining us today on the King's Report. We'll see you tomorrow, 5 a.m. sharp on the King's Report. God bless, Godspeed, and may His kingdom come. We'll see you next time.